on you. It's going to be non-stop action as usual. We've got two tag team matches. One is a handicap match between Hulk Hogan and Andre the Giant. Two of them going against King Kong Bundy, Big John Studd, and Bobby the Brain Heenan.
I don't know if it's a handicap or not.
That's some handicap, but I think the handicap might be for King Kong Bundy and John Studd by having Bobby Heenan on their side.
That could be, and I'll tell you, we also have World Wrestling Federation champions Brutus Beefcake and Greg the Hammer Valentine going against the Dynamite Kid and Davey Boy Smith, the challengers. That's not all. A lot of single matches. SD Jones is here. B. Brian Blair, Neidhart, I tell you, they're all here. But now let's go into the ring and get the announcement for our first matchup tonight at the World Wrestling Federation here at the Spectrum before a sellout crowd.
Wrestling fans, here's your first bout of the evening. In this corner, he is in the blue trunks, 270 pounds from Philadelphia. Here is Ron Shaw. And here he is, ladies and gentlemen, at 280 pounds, the pride of Tampa, Florida. Dan Spivey!
Well, there's the announcement. I'll tell you, this young fellow, Dan Spivey, Lord Alfred Hayes, was here, I think, for the first time a month ago. Perhaps he's been here the last 2 months. I don't remember. But I know he was here last month. And I'll tell you that he's gained a lot of support from the local fans.
Yes, he's beginning to impress everybody all around the world with what he's been able to accomplish in such a short time. He's really an exciting young prospect. Last time I was here, which was about a year ago, Dick, in between that time, Shaw had broken his leg. So it would be interesting for me now to see how Shaw's going to shape out.
Well, I talked to Shaw a little while ago back by the tunnel, maybe a half hour or so ago, and I said, how's the wheel, meaning the leg?
Uh-huh.
He said, okay, it's all right. It took a little while to heal, but we're okay. So we'll find out how okay.
Yes, and he's certainly going to be a test for Dan Spivey, and the top critics of wrestling are expecting a lot of things from Spivey. Let's see if he's going to live up to that tonight.
Well, I'll tell you what you might be, what I'm going to be looking for, Alfred, is Ron Shaw, who's quite a big guy, but considering that one leg has been broken, I want to see if maybe that hinders his maneuverability, and on top of that, would it maybe prevent him, if he goes this way, of doing any body slam where he's got to lift an excessive amount of weight?
Yeah, he may stay away from that. It's possible, you know. But Spivey is a young lad. He's got a lot of energy. He's a little bit raw in some quarters, a little bit inexperienced. And Ron Shaw, you can never say he's inexperienced, but Ron Shaw has seemed not to be able to live up to those big heights that had been predicted for him. Maybe tonight he's going to make his mark.
Well, he did a nice step over there, came crashing down on the arm of, in fact, the left arm of Ron Shaw, and he's feeling the pins and needles up and down the wing.
He certainly is. He's rubbing that as well he might, because he's a big lad.
He really is.
Spivey.
He did a series of turns and got it back of Spivey, but now Spivey reversed it.
Yeah.
And has an arm lock on Shaw. He's trying to figure out what to do, whether grab his leg, go under, or... Well, he's not.
Yes, I'll tell you another thing that's unusual for Shaw is he's actually facing an opponent who appears to be about an inch taller than him and probably a few pounds heavier as well.
Well, the guy, Spivey, looks very long and lean and gives you a lot of body. He's not, he's well set up. He's got a great build, but he tends to be kind of long. I don't know how much leverage he can generate against a slightly shorter adversary.
Yes, Spivey's a good lad. At the moment, he's moving quite confidently in the ring, and that's good.
Well, there's a nice little arm takedown by Shaw, but then it's right into the scissors. Spivey shows a little bit of thought there, kept his cool, and he breaks it. And Shaw showing frustration, huh?
He's not happy with that at all.
No, he's gonna take Malasecki, the referee, aside.
Yeah. I think Shaw thought he was going to have a pushover with Spivey. He probably hasn't seen Spivey before.
I don't think he has.
So So well, he may have a few surprises in store for, well, him, but I think Spivey may have a few more surprises
well,
for sure.
Well, there's a surprise. Spivey's doing an arm drag takedown. There's another. Oh. Shaw. Uh-huh. Shaw's bailing out. Uh-huh.
Yeah, came down on that left shoulder again. And that was the left arm he was rubbing, and now he's rubbing his knee. Is that the leg that was broken?
I saw him ready to bail. I knew after the second arm drag takedown, I said, he's going to go for the floor. And sure enough, he's bought himself some time, and I don't really argue with that. A lot of guys do that when they're kind of shaken up.
Good idea. He's been around Shaw. He knows how to take a breather here and there.
Well, if you don't, you're going to get killed.
And no time short.
For sure. Well, I tell you, we've got a sold-out Spectrum, folks. I mean, they're to the rafters, and they're not jiving you. Little arm bar on Shaw by Spivey. He's he's making that pain go right up to the arm armpit, right to the shoulder joint. Oh, step over her. Shakes the wrist and the arm.
Keeping on that left arm, you'll notice all the time, Dick.
Well,
the hallmark of a good wrestler, if you get something good going for you, come back to it. Keep coming back to it.
Yep.
Shaw seems quite content, though. He doesn't seem to bother him. It doesn't seem to bother him too much.
Oh, nice shoulder block. Nice takedown by Spivey. Whoa. Oh, another arm drag. Do you see the way he whipped all that weight of Ron Shaw? Just make him flew through the air and crash down on that arm drag.
And so rapid as well, Dick.
Whew. He whipped him, boy.
Did he execute that?
Snapped him like a whip. The guy's got some upper body strength. Look, you can tell he works up with the weights, Spivey, I mean.
Oh, he's well put together, Spivey.
Of course, they all work out with the weights.
They certainly do these days.
Now, there, that answered my question. I didn't know that Shaw would go to a body slam, considering, well, now that we know that he's had problems of the one shoulder and arm, courtesy of Spivey, but whether because of the leg injury some time back, he'd be able to lift that weight, but he did.
Well, he's going to have to do that, you know. I think Shaw realizes now he's not in the ring with a pushover.
Nope.
And he's going to have to try and do everything, and that means using that leg that has been damaged.
Well, I don't have to tell you, a successful wrestler that you've been, you don't step through the ropes unless you're ready. I don't care if you're not ready. You're ready.
Right. Absolutely.
Caught an elbow, I think, right in the, maybe in the throat. Oh, how many times?
Yeah.
That shows the experience of Shaw. He saw it coming. He said, all right, I'm going to give him both knees. He wants me. I'm going to give him knees instead. Spivey came on down.
Ooh. Absolutely. Shaw played a little possum there.
Yep.
And I think he's still playing it to a degree as well, giving himself a breather. But he lured Spivey right into that.
He did that. And Shaw is a tough dude. He slammed Spivey's head right on the mat.
Yep.
A little hip roll, takedown.
And snapped him over very smartly
now,
there.
All right. Now we're gone with a fist. Uh-huh. Looks like it's a battle royal starting, huh? Any rules are in effect. Oh, he went for the eyes, I think. He's wearing some adhesive tape on each wrist. Spivey's over the top and down.
God.
Ooh, there he is, our ringside cameraman, very alert. Picks up Spivey on the floor. And I'll tell you, this floor of the Spectrum is not what you call a cushion by any means.
Spivey, with all that hair, of course, is vulnerable to a thing like that. Shaw's not going to be slow picking him up by the hair, throwing him around by the hair, and he's certainly got lift to throw him over that top rope, because Spivey went out about 2 feet over the top rope.
Well, now Malasecki, the referee, is warning Shaw back. You got to give Spivey time to get in, but Shaw's right out on the ring apron. Going to haul him in, looks to be. Oh! Took him off the top rope, right across the throat. Alfred,
A damaging hold.
Have you had that done to you a time or two?
Yes, I did. And I tell you something, I didn't feel too good about it either.
Could you swallow a few days later?
Oh, hardly. But Spivey really now showing a little of his experience. And Shaw's taken command of this bout now.
Well, he has. And Shaw has Spivey outside. He went between the second and top ropes, right outside again. And Shaw is exalting the fact that he is number one, which is the... is really disputed by the fans. There's a count going on against Spivey. I don't know what count it is. Can't tell.
Well, Shaw's very confident there. Well, he might be, because he's taking control of this. The impetus is swung in his favor, and he's going to keep it that way.
All right.
He made a mistake. Oh!
brings that hammer down.
Uh-huh.
Elbow came smashing down the top of the head of Ron Shaw. Spivey right over top. Didn't anchor the leg at all. Didn't hook the leg. So Shaw broke it. Gonna take him into the corner. Whoa. Oh-ho. Here we go. Almost lost it.
Nearly lost it, yeah. But hung on. That was determination. Determination.
He's got a little suplex.
Oh, a snap suplex, and that's from nearly 7 feet by the time Spivey out.
All right, he better hook the leg. I think Monsoon and I talk about that all the time.
Yes, he would.
He says,
Bulldog.
Oh! This baby, roll him over, hook the leg. That's all she wrote.
Good victory for young Spivey. He showed what he's made of. Took some punishment, was able to come back.
Well, he's picked up more than just a few fans, I think, here tonight at the Spectrum. Let's get the decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner, Dan Spivey.
Well, there you have it. The young man from Tampa, Florida, Lord Alfred Hayes, doing a number on the veteran by at least a few years, Ron Shaw from Philadelphia. And that's the way it is. Dick Graham here with Lord Alfred Hayes, ringside. We'll be right back with Championship Wrestling from the Spectrum.
Friends on the road.
Are you crazy? Are you out of your mind?
Fandango.
It's the stuff legends are made of, son.
All right, Dick Graham again with Lord Alfred Hayes ringside, the World Wrestling Federation exciting program. And Lord Alfred, we've got a tremendous program, 9 matches. We've just seen the first one. And we're awaiting the two participants for event number 2. But a little later on, Adrian Adonis coming back to Philadelphia.
And have you seen him recently?
Not lately.
My God, you're in for a surprise.
Changed a little
bit.
You
are in for a surprise.
I saw him earlier, but I had not seen him here at the Spectrum for a while.
Well,
a matter of months.
I can't wait to see him. And if you haven't seen him, I can't wait to hear what you're going to say about him.
All right. Well, I think the camera will probably do the obvious.
Well, let's not say anything more about him. Let's wait till he comes here.
You got to
keep
deal.
Everybody in suspense.
All right. Tony, Mr. USA Atlas is on the program. Well, let's see. Let's hold back here because the crowd's getting stirred up again. And we have a gentleman who is well known here at the Spectrum. I didn't say well loved, but I said well known. Is he full of energy or is he?
He is indeed. And say what you might, he's a very, very successful wrestler. And he's determined to carry on in that particular way.
I'll take him with me in a back alley sometime. on my side.
Yes, definitely.
On my side.
Yeah. As long as he's on your side, I'll be with you, too.
Well, Neidhart blocking the way from B. Brian Blair, who's about to enter the ring area. But referee Dusty Feldbaum warning Neidhart back. Jim the Anvil Neidhart. Let's get the announcement.
Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. In this corner, 280 pounds from Reno, Nevada, Jim the Anvil Neidhart. And his opponent, ladies and gentlemen, 235 pounds, Tampa, Florida, B. Brian Blair.
I'll tell you, Lord Alfred, I like B. Brian Blair. We haven't seen him maybe more than a handful of times here at the Spectrum, but I like his style. He's a young guy, and I don't mean coming up. He's already up, but the fact is he's a very quick wrestler, has a nice repertoire of holds, and he's against a guy who can maul you to death, this guy.
Oh, golly. He's a bruising-type wrestler, the Anvil. He doesn't know the meaning of pain or fear. And Blair has something on his hands here. But, you know, Tampa has become a hotbed of young wrestlers.
Yep.
I saw Brian Blair there about 3 years ago. And at that time, I said, watch this fellow. Watch this young boy, Brian Blair, because he's going to develop.
Uh-huh.
And he's certainly fulfilling all that promise now.
Well, he looks to be carrying about 230, maybe. He's not maybe as much bulk as Neidhart, but, well, he's quick, though.
Yes, really. And he's put together. But Neidhart is a powerhouse. Look at him. They tell me when he played for the Dallas Cowboys, even the Cowboys were afraid of him.
Well, that's quite a tribute to a man, I think.
Really?
Even the Dallas Cowboys in the Philadelphia area. He says, I see one area where Neidhart has got to be cautious, and he's carrying that patch of hair on his chin. I think that could be a weapon used against him, you think?
Yes, it could easily be, but, you know, Blair will not be lured into some sort of action where he's going to lose his cool, because he knows that the wrestler who keeps his cool is a successful wrestler.
Well, Neidhart literally lifted B. Brian Blair by partially the trunks and elsewhere, lifted him and shoved him about 5 or 6 feet away. So this is the battle of strength. You can see the cockiness, the arrogance, if you will, of Jim the Anvil Neidhart. And, well, Brian Blair's in for a long evening. He's got a side headlock
really
on him now.
I think Neidhart thinks he's got this sewn up already, you know.
Well,
look at him.
I wouldn't do that if I would never step in a ring with a wrestler and think I had it made. Not the World Wrestling Federation.
And certainly not with Brian Blair.
No way.
Mind you, it doesn't hurt to try and psych out your opponent and let him think that you've got everything under control anyway.
That's different, but you can't presume you got it made. Side headlock, now he reverses. Pulls him right along.
Those powerful arms he's got. Blair trapped nicely in that headlock, and unfortunately for Blair at the moment, he doesn't seem to be able to move from that hole, but he's going to think his way out.
Well, Blair's trying for the pace here, like pushing the chin, but doesn't seem to be having quite any success with leverage. Whoa. Uh-huh, battle of strength there, gets out of that side headlock.
Very supple move.
All right, an anvil, hair pull. I don't know whether Dusty Feldbaum or the referee saw that, but definite hair pull. I know the ringsiders saw it.
Well, we saw that, but I'm sure the referee didn't see it because Anvil waited until the referee was blindsided.
That's right.
He knows how to wrestle, Anvil. He's been around a long time.
That's why he has been around a long time.
And, you know, the funny thing about this is that both Blair and Neidhart have very, very good tag team partners, but here they are in a single match. They obviously want to prove something.
Nice leg trip, took him down, and now Brian Blair is going to hand it back again. What goes around comes around.
look at Neidhart's face now. He knows he made a mistake somewhere along the line.
He really did. Well, great maneuver by Brian Blair. Just kind of tripped him, got him down, but as soon as he was down, Blair was on him. Didn't wait. Boy, you can't wait. You can't give a guy time.
Blair tried to trap that huge right leg of Neidhart, but he felt the strength in that and thought, well, stick with the arm. See what happens here.
Well, he's gone for the shoulder, the upper arm area on the left arm. Neidhart, you leave your middle open there, as Blair has for maybe, right like that. Oh! Blair went right down the chin whiskers of Neidhart.
Well, you called it, Dick, because I didn't think Blair would do that.
Well, I just figured it was too prominent. It was a possibility. How would I know?
Right.
But he can't grab him by the hair, for sure.
No, you're right. There'd be no way he could grab that hair.
All right, he's going around back, still moving that arm, trying to block off the circulation.
But look at Neidhart, he's like a big block of cement there, isn't he? You can just see all that power in his body, the way he spreads his legs, gets his balance, and keeps it.
In football parlance, in the National Football League, he would make a nice running guard. All right, Blair's up and down now, but he maintains the hold. Blair has Neidhart, takes him to the canvas, rams that knee into the shoulder, step over toe hold, or arm hold.
Oh. You know, it takes a lot of guts to hang on to a hold like that Blair did, because you take a lot of punishment when you're slammed and you still maintain that hold. Blair did it. I don't know whether that's advisable or not. Sometimes it's better just to let go and try and have another go at it and try and protect yourself. But
well, what you say is true, and you only know whether your thinking was correct after the fact.
That's absolutely
true. If it happens to work. Well, Blair's still applying pressure on the upper arm, the shoulder area of Jim the Anvil Neidhart. Neidhart finally on his feet. And Blair is still working hard. Going for the tights is Neidhart. Warned away, taking him to the rope. Back, oh! Sunset flip! Boy, that was about 2.5. I'll tell you, that was close.
That was close, but I don't think Blair thought for one moment he was going to pin Neidhart there, but he did that to let Neidhart know that he can do it anytime he wants.
For sure.
To. And that's good psychology, too.
Well, he has Neidhart down, pretty much down on his stomach. He's grabbing for the bottom rope, and now they got a break, and that's it. And Neidhart's very smart.
Yeah.
I'll use whatever. Whoa! Right over the dog.
Put his foot right through the chair. That's upset Neidhart. Put his foot right through the chair there. Nearly got trapped in it.
With our bell, a microphone, the ring mic.
He had everything hanging on there. The bell, the desk, the chair, even the timekeeper, I think he had hanging on to his leg.
I'll tell you, he's so nasty. I'm glad his mother wasn't sitting in that chair. I wonder what would have happened to her, you know?
He's really upset now with Blair, and he feels a little bit more than embarrassed.
Well, some of the kids at ringside are indicating they think he's number one. I guess that's what they were doing. Neidhart warning Blair back. The referee says, come on, give him room to get in. He does grab some space between the second and top ropes. Now he's in, so we connect again. Or will in a moment, I presume. Got a great wrestling program, fans. I mean, you talk about your non-stop action. The World Wrestling Federation, it's here tonight again. And a sellout at the Spectrum. A sellout. If there's a seat here, I'd be surprised.
Yes, and the atmosphere here is absolutely electric.
Yep, there's a great word. That's true. There wasn't a seat available after Wednesday of this week for Saturday night's event.
That is fantastic.
It really is. Well, Philadelphia, great fans here, great sports fans.
And they know their wrestling, too. As a matter of fact, they know their sports here, don't they?
Yes, they are. They're very good fans.
They are wonderful sports fans.
They're a little disrespectful if you don't like you. If they say you're a Dallas Cowboy and come to town and you're at an Eagles game, why, don't look for any respect for Eagles fans. And I'm one of them, boy. Okay, Neidhart takes it. Oh, man. Saw him coming, ducked a little bit, used that momentum of Brian Blair and shoved him right outside the ring, and he's hit the floor and man alive. Dusty Feldbaumer warning Neidhart back.
Blair caught a heavy blow to the back of his body there.
Three.
Shot through those.
Count of four. Count of five, it looks like.
Crashed to the cement there, and he really winded.
Neidhart's got to give him space. Oh, no, he's going to help him in now. Right off the top rope.
And Neidhart better be careful because he's going to get himself disqualified if he doesn't obey the referee's instructions.
That's right. Well, the referee's got to take command or it's all over. Going after Blair again on that top rope. Smashing an arm. Whoa! Forearm right down the back of the neck, the upper shoulder area.
He's bending the rules just as far as he can. And now he knows he's got to do that because Blair's is not going to stand back and be overawed and overpowered by Neidhart.
That's right. Now he's got to bring that elbow. Whoa!
There he goes.
He didn't seem to move him too much, Neidhart.
No, there wasn't a great deal of power in that.
Maybe not.
Unfortunately, he's had the power knocked out of him with that blow to the floor there. Neidhart relentless in his attack.
Well,
he's not going to let up.
He went for the eyes there, you know.
Yeah, he's not going to let up. He's going to push all the time. He's going to keep the pressure on Blair. And one can hardly blame him for that.
For sure. All right, got him in a corner. Lays a forearm across the chin and maybe into the throat area again. Hey, takes one back. Gives one back again. He's going for the eyes again on Brian Blair. Oh, man.
That was just a tremendously hard elbow that Blair took to the jaw there as well in that corner.
Yes, it was. Blair's really literally on the ropes. I mean, he's really wobbly. Can't see too well. He's shaken up. And there's Neidhart right on top of him. Gives him a fist to the right cross and kick him out the... Oh, come on, ref. Take command. Let's go, Dusty Feldbaumer.
Well,
I'm not saying take sides here, but man...
Well, the referee's warning Neidhart, and well, he might. At the same time, the few shots that Blair has got in this last couple of minutes seem to have been very ineffective.
Yeah. Doesn't carry any real...
No, he hasn't had any power behind him. Nobody behind those blows. Let's see if he can get something back into his physical strength.
Well, he's got him in a bear hug and squeezing right down the lower back. And Neidhart, look at those arms pumping away. They are powerful. And I don't know. At this point in time, it's about, he won't give in. He's telling the referee, no, I don't concede. No, I don't. I don't. I can't allow it. So far, so good. But now he's down on both on his tiptoes.
The longer Blair can stand that, of course, the weaker Anvil Neidhart is going to become.
That's right. Well, he got some power behind him. Couple of elbows. Neidhart going for the lower legs. Takes another elbow. Another elbow. Oh, back up again. Oh.
Reverse atomic drop. But once again, those few blows that Blair did get in, they didn't seem to have much effect upon Neidhart, and I suspect there's not a lot of power behind those blows of Blair.
Neidhart is a tough dude, I'm telling you. He's...
Is he not?
And Brian Blair is really... I don't know. I don't like the forecast.
Well, what a devastating, punishing move that. Of course, Neidhart is the power of the Hart Foundation. The tag team of him and Brett the Hitman, and now he's showing you why he is the power.
He's taking it right across the top rope, right across the eyes.
Blair has been struggling this last 5 minutes.
And he really has. I don't know how much he can take this time.
No, he's trying to find an opening somewhere, and it's just not coming. He hasn't had any luck at all in this
match. Really, after the first, early on in this match, he just really hasn't been able to do it. Now he's going behind the back. Is there a choke? No, chin lock anyway, but no choke hold apparently. But that doesn't help when your head's being pulled back.
No, and Anvil's keeping him close to the ropes there so that he does have an avenue of escape for himself.
Right.
Another blow to the midriff of Anvil, but again.
Body slam.
Whoa, what a body slam.
He caught that right at the buns and went right up the vertebrae, up to the top of the head.
And a shoulder tackle there that had a lot of power and a lot of
power. Whoa! I'll tell you, Blair, I don't know where it came from, but all of a sudden he said, maybe enough is enough. Blair is upset, Neidhart is hurting, and now it's payback time, fan. How much Brian Blair has left, I don't know, but he's doing it to him, taking him right across the top rope, Alfred.
Yes, that's what we call in England tit for tat,
uh-huh.
And he certainly gave it to him there.
Oh, clothesline.
And left arm, too, that's awkward.
Blair.
If you're not ready for that left arm.
Oh, you'll make a choir boy out of him. But you know, I don't know how much Blair has left. I mean, he's on a roll right now. I wish him luck, but boy.
Let's see what power he's got here.
Oh, caught him in a abdominal stretch. What can he do? I don't know. Now he lost him.
But he's back.
Oh,
for a pin.
One, two. Oh, he grabbed the rope. You couldn't see because of the cameraman. And I wouldn't see. I don't know whether Neidhart was using the bottom rope for leverage or what.
Sleeper hold.
Oh, sleeper.
Got him nicely. Well tucked in, using a lot of leverage with that.
Dusty Feldbarber sliding a hand under the arm to see if there's any choking up in the air. There was none, so he's satisfied.
And this will take the strength out of you in a hurry, a sleeper hold.
Well, see how much Brian Blair has. And this is a great spot for the Anvil to see if he can come back. How much is deep down, is inside him.
Ah!
Well, he lost it for sure. Blair is outside the ring on the apron. Neidhart's inside.
Anvil's walking over there, but he doesn't seem to be as steady as he was on his feet. As a matter of fact, those blows of Blair are beginning to tell now.
He's trying to get him at his toppling. I don't know.
Got him.
No.
Whoa.
Roll out the 2.5. Oh, Blair. Blair is angry, says, man.
He is fired up now.
He really is. Neidhart is taking the punishment. Whoa.
Oh.
Whoa.
Oh.
Oh, he did it. He body slammed him, and I tell you, that ought to give Brian Blair a lift, and also a lift to Neidhart. Oh,
he made the supreme effort, and unfortunately, when he went to cap it, it wasn't there.
Right. Lord Alfred, he tried to give him the coup de grace, I think, and just didn't. Oh! Blair rolls away, and the double hammer slam fails. Whoop.
Hooked him in a small package.
Two. Oh, man.
2.5 doesn't count.
The fans say, wait a minute, Rev, let's get a fast, I didn't anticipate they're saying get a faster count. He slipped off the body, upper body, but it took him down with a trip. I don't know. One, two.
What Blair is doing, he's varying his attack, the diversity of it, from the top to the bottom. Now back to that abdominal stretch.
He's going to try to get him over backwards again. I think it rolled him over and come out on top, I think. He'll play off this abdominal stretch.
Well, Blair tried that before, and then he went to the sleeper, and it seemed to be successful.
Well, I'll tell you, Blair showed me a nice repertoire there. He had some moves planned, and yes, apparently they worked out very well.
Well, he's come into this match, obviously, with a game plan.
Got to. You better.
It didn't look as if it was succeeding for him halfway through this match, but now Blair has got his confidence back. The pendulum is beginning to swing, or has swung in his favor, and he's now beginning to punish Anvil. I don't think Anvil likes this at all.
He doesn't. You can tell that. Pain on the face, that tells you a story.
Yeah, he was treating some of those blows by Blair with scorn and a little bit of mockery as well, but that was a...
Look, there's a look at a tight close-up. Oh, boy. What do we have here? That's the time?
I think that could be the time limit.
I think it's all over, and I think it's a draw. If I'm not mistaken, I heard the bell. We'll get the official announcement in just a moment. The referee, Frankie Talent, will get it from Dusty Feldbomber.
Unless that was a submission that Blair had on him there, the referee called for the bell.
I can't imagine either guy submitting, but whoa.
Look out.
Oh, come on. Come on, Neidhart. The bell rang. It's all over.
Now, ref, come on.
Frustration taking over.
Blair has forsaken any idea of holes here. He's just going to whop him as hard as he can.
He came around.
He scored the big guy.
Came around half right and down with Neidhart.
Uh-oh, the B. Oh. Oh, just a little late getting
out. Gave him a late shot. Now he's gone. Okay. Well, Neidhart at least has acknowledged the fact the match is over. We heard the bell. Dusty Feldbomber's instructing the referee. Okay, let's get the announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dusty Feldbomber, the referee, calls this bout a draw.
Well, the fans not buying it, but anyway.
No, a little bit tough on Blair that, because he should have disqualified it. Oh, wow.
All right, fans, you're watching Spectrum Wrestling exclusively on Prism. We'll be right back with more.
His name shouted in battle.
Is it true that he once killed a lion?
Spoken in fear.
He was here.
That's not possible, my lord.
He was here.
Hailed in victory.
He has robbed me of my God, my people.
The slayer of Goliath. A rebel. A fighter.
Well, Lord Alfred Hayes, you talk about the excitement of watching wrestling on Prism television, but there's nothing like coming down to the Spectrum. 19,710 fans are here at the Spectrum for this January 11th event. They must like wrestling.
Oh, they love it. They love it.
They kind of like it.
Wrestling right now is riding on a high, and it should do, because it is the most exciting professional sport there is in the whole world of professional sports. And a little while ago, you may have heard me shout out, wow. And when I shout wow, that was because I saw that particular figure that you were holding in your hand, 19,710. And that's only the people here.
I'll tell you, man, this is Sports City, Philadelphia Sports City. And we're ringside at the Spectrum. The two participants for the next event are in the ring. And Hercules Hernandez haranguing the fans, and they're doing the same. Let's get the introductions from our announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, in this corner, at 265 pounds, from Tampa, Florida, here is Hercules Hernandez. And in this corner, he will take on 238 pounds. From Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, S.D. Jones!
too much. Don't you love it? I mean, don't you really love it, man? What an outfit he has. And he wrestles just as well as he looks in that colorful attire. S.D. Jones from Philadelphia and her Hercules Hernandez from Tampa, Florida. You talk about a lot of the great wrestlers, the young ones coming out of the Southland.
Yes.
Lord Alfred, you're right.
Yes, well, I was telling you about that. And, you know, it attracted the attention of Fred Blassie. And he went down to Tampa, Florida to see what all that those young wrestlers were about. And he came up with this fellow. I mean, he could have come up with Blair. He could have come up maybe with Dennis Fiby, but not Fred Blassie. He came up with Hercules Hernandez, and
well,
that is his discovery.
As I always say to fans, like him or not, but Blassie does know talent.
Oh, he does indeed. And he knows what to do with it. Well,
yes, he does.
As well, he can maneuver his men into good positions, and he is an expert at trapping people into contracts that they don't really wish to be in.
And he's an expert in leading the unsuspected adversary to his...
Right, coming to my parlor,
wrestler, yes.
Said the spider.
Come into my web.
Yes, right.
Well, all right, S.D. Jones, I don't know that he's seen Hercules Hernandez before, at least not in this ring, and they connect, and there's a pushing, shoving match, and Hercules is well-named. The man has all kinds of strength, but S.D. Jones is a pretty cool customer. He's wrestled everybody. He doesn't run from anybody, and he's a cool guy.
S.D. Jones knows his wrestling back to front, inside out, and upside down.
We know he was ill about a year or two back, and I think finally he's bulked up to his old weight, maybe a little bit beyond now.
Yes, he's looking very, very sharp, S.D.
And I mentioned the weight and the bulking up and the strength, because he took Hernandez just a moment ago. I just literally shoved him aside. And that's 265 pounds.
Really? And 265 pounds of muscle and power as well.
Uh-huh.
I don't say too much for the head, but a lot of the body strength there.
All right. He's got great upper body. Look at the shoulder there. He's pumped a lot of iron in this time. Side headlock by SD on Hernandez.
Hernandez showing good balance there.
Whoa! Nice headbutt by SD. And down goes the Hercules.
And SD Jones showing a good deal of awareness as well.
Well, SD's the left-hander, man. And he says, hey, I'll give you the old boxing pose here if you want to do that with me. I'm ready for you.
Yeah.
Anything you want to lay on me, I'll respond.
You know what I like about SD? Once he gets into the ring, he knows his way around and he controls that ring.
Yes, he does. He controls areas of it, blocks it off. He does what he's doing.
Yes, he does. His, what could you call that, zone attack or zone offense, defense, but he has it all.
All right, kick to the midsection, an elbow, and there's a smash to the side of the face by Hercules Hernandez. And he says, hey, look at me, I'm pretty and I'm on a roll. He takes him to the ropes. Oh, ho, oh, ho, ho, ho. SD saw that coming. He says, yeah, man. And a flying headbutt, and down goes the Hercules. And he said, wait a minute. Hold it. Hold it. I thought I had something going a moment ago.
And now he's got a headache going for himself.
Number nine. He's going to take that on the plane tonight. Well.
SD looking good. Looking really
yes,
well.
Yes, he is. He's cool. And the ringsiders have gotten the attention of Hercules Hernandez and started, they're giving it to him.
Blassie has predicted a big future for this man, Hercules Hernandez. Blassie is already talking about terms of him attacking Hulk Hogan, assailing him for that world championship. But let us see first what he does with S.D. Jones.
Well, he's got him near the ropes now. Down, he's kicking at him and using the ropes for a little bit of added leverage. And Ray Malasecki, the referee, warning him off. He says, come on, you got to break that stuff. Give the man a chance to get away from the ropes. He starts kicking at him again.
And if he does that too much, he'll be disqualified and he'll have lost this belt.
Yeah, I think so, but Hernandez seems to be out of control right now.
He was sharp. He was quick, though, mind you, with that attack. Tremendous right hand to Jones there. Absolutely floored Jones. But I've seen Jones take punishment like that before and come right back.
He has taken a wealth of... I've seen him shed blood from one end of the ring to the other on a given night and over a bunch of nights. But I'll tell you, the guy, SD, always comes back. Always comes at you. And Hernandez taunting SD. Taking a smash to the side of the head. Down he goes again.
That's what he's doing. He's taunting him. He's mocking him. And in fact, he's even toying with him. And that's a dangerous thing to do with S.D. Jones.
You don't get... Well, I tell you, I've seen him get angry, man. And it's not pleasant. Whoa, flying smash to the side of the face. Looks like gave him a sidearm, sort of a forearm from the side. There's an elbow off the against the jaw. SC down now, just literally leaning against the bottom rope. I'm not sure he knows what day it is or where he is. Kick further down. Now is being kneed by Hernandez using the ropes. He's being warned off. Malasek's got to maintain control.
His last blows at SD Jones have certainly taken their toll, but SD Jones coming back to his feet. He's not looking as if he's completely out, but I would suspect that if the gladiator here, Hercules Hernandez, thinks he's going to beat Jones, he better resort to something more like this than just punching Jones, because he's not going to knock him out.
No, he's trying a sleeper maneuver right now, but they're both down, and certainly SD is saying, wait a minute, hold it, hold it. All right, SD back on his feet. He gives him an elbow, another elbow smash, takedown. I think he went for the throat on that to take him down. Hernandez knows all the legal and illegal maneuvers, doesn't he?
Yeah, plus he's found himself a good man here.
Yep.
A man, the type of man he likes, a killer, a man who doesn't care what he does to win a match. Very intense, and he's going to stop at no... rules are not going to stop him doing what he wants or achieving what he wants. Jones trying to struggle back to his feet, and if he does get to his feet, he'll have accomplished something here, because there's a tremendously wearing down hold that Hercules has on him.
Whoa, he gives him a double shot to the midsection, and still Hernandez maintains that hold, comes back with another shot, and now we're just battling away at one another.
And Hernandez will lose that because Jones is rock hard.
Whoa! Oh,
wow.
Jones outside the ring. Wow, he kicked down the small of his back on the edge of the ring, man. I tell you, talk about smarts. And there's a shot of SD Jones on the floor, down on both knees, but still trying to get up. I think he's favoring his arm, Lord Albert.
Yes, he is indeed. The referee did admonish Hercules Hernandez for pulling Jones out by the trunks there. And well, he should, because that's exactly what he did. But Jones, as you say, seemed to be favoring his leg, and it was his left leg, so maybe he's damaged that left knee.
Hey, looking at the face of SD Jones, he looked like getting tired of this stuff. He says, man, enough is getting to be enough. It just looks like that's what his face was saying. I don't know. We'll find out.
Yes, I think he's getting fed up with that sort of treatment, and he's not going to take that much longer.
Uh-huh. Well, if he's going to get back in the ring, now's the time. Hernandez prancing around. He smashed the back of the head with an elbow. Oh, man. Takes the knee inside the right leg by Hernandez. That doesn't always work.
Certainly not with Jones.
You don't smash his head on a turnbuckle. SD is the champion. He's the inventor, maybe, of the headbutt, I'll tell you.
And you won't knock him out either like that.
Whoa! Look, watch. SD says... Hernandez says, wait a minute. Hey, don't do that to me. Whoa! Karate chop, he brought that. Oh, and a headbutt, and down goes Hernandez. Whoa!
Tremendous block.
Oh!
A one-legged knee drop there.
That's good.
A very fortunate winner there, Hercules Hernandez. And although I say fortunate, he took the opportunity and took advantage of that opportunity when it arose.
Well, he did. Hernandez very pleased with himself, of course.
A shade lucky. Definitely a shade lucky.
Well, we'll get the ring announcer in here and get the decision. Very obviously a pin, but we'll get the official announcement right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner of the bout, Hercules Hernandez!
Good. He learned the count. Yes. 1, 2, 3.
Yes. 2 and 1, is that? Or could that be 1 and 2?
I think I've seen horses do that. Yeah. Terrific. That's nice. All right, let's watch the events leading up to it. Shoulder block takedown by SD. And he caught him in midair. The momentum was going in his favor and brought him right down and boom, boom, boom. Woo. Well, coming up next, fans, the Spectrum return of Adrian Adonis. You're watching Spectrum Wrestling exclusively on Prism.
Dr. Stevens has everything a man could want, but someone is trying to take it all away from him.
It was not an accident.
The report said you might have been jaywalking.
Somebody tried to kill me.
Not even the police seem to be able to help. Time is running out. The murderer is near. Roger Moore, the naked face.
Lore for Alfred Hayes, we've got the body beautiful in that ring. I'll tell you, Dick Graham has never anything but amazed when I pass this guy back by the dressing room to see him in the ring. Tony Atlas, I'm talking about.
And doesn't Tony, he keep himself in
I ever come back again in the next life, I want your body.
There he is. Oh, there it is. I don't know what.
I know.
Just look at him.
Well,
I told you, Dick, did I not?
I knew the hair was blonde, but I didn't know the rest of it. And I'm not too sure what I'm seeing.
That is Adrian out of the closet.
Well, do they say when he's out on the town that he's a gay blade? I don't know. What are we saying here?
Well, he said himself he was out of the closet. He told everybody on TNT a few weeks ago, I am out of the closet and I am happy. Well, I guess he is by the look of him.
Well, let's get the announcement. We'll find out maybe what this is all about.
Here we go, wrestling fans. In this corner, 292 pounds from New York City. Ladies and gentlemen, here is the adorable Adrian Adonis. And he will take on 250 pounds, Roanoke, Virginia's Mr. USA, Tony Atlas, Mr. USA.
You know, Lord Alfred Hayes, Adrian Adonis has bulked up, and I mean really, I mean he's carrying 290 pounds, is it? And I think the last time that I recall seeing him here a year or so back, he was something maybe 250, perhaps.
Yes, well, he has put that weight on because he's developed a particular hole that needs extra body weight. And believe me, the hole
gets it all above the waist, though. Yeah, he gets.
Well, he uses all that body weight to help him subdue his opponent in that particular hole. We may see him use that hole, and if we do, I'll point it out to you. But he hasn't been able to accomplish it in his last two matches, although he's been successful in his last two matches.
Well, I hope he doesn't break a nail.
Or an eyelash.
Whatever. Oh, what's this? Tony Atlas says, hey, what's this stuff, man? What's this all about? Tony said, wait a minute. Woo! You told me, you warned me.
Yeah. did I surprise you still, or did he surprise you?
And then some.
Yeah.
You are the master of understatement.
Well, thank you. 1986 is opening with a bang, isn't it, Dick?
You. Out of the closet, eh?
Yes, that's what he said. He said 1986 is going to be his year because now he is free. He has no more guilt complexes. He is really the Adrian Adonis that he's always wanted to be. And he's even added adorable to his name.
All right, well, I'll go along with it. Why not? Tony says, come on, boys. Let's get it on. Get rid of the paraphernalia, the ribbons and stuff.
I think Adrian Adonis just loved parading up and down in those ribbons. He certainly has an extrovert touch to him.
What's this stuff? He's going outside with the ring apron. Oh, he's handing down. Okay.
What? Streamers. The colorful streamers.
Woo!
He is bedecking his second with those streamers.
I'll tell you, man. That attendant's not too sure what's gone.
Well, I think maybe at last he's ready.
He didn't take the bow out of his hair, or I guess. Oh, there comes the bow. He puts it on top of the ring post on the far side, and I guess that means we must be ready to do battle.
Yes.
Or something.
But make no mistake, he can do battle.
Yes, he can.
Never underestimate Adrian Adonis.
Well, the fans are letting him know. Oh, I don't believe some of the stuff that's going on ringside. I can't describe it. I won't describe it. Adrian says, wait a minute.
Woo! He's taken off back to the dressing room.
Oh, wait. I was going to ask him, does he get back to his dressing room or his boudoir?
Either. But he's headed out there somewhere.
Well, wherever.
And if he doesn't come back pretty soon, he's going to forfeit this match.
It's all over. I don't know. I have a taste of the bizarre. If I were Tony Atlas, maybe his mind doesn't run that way. I'd go get that bow and put it on top of his head just in case adorable Adrian comes back again, which apparently, yeah, here he comes. Or here comes Adrian.
Yes, he's coming back. He allowed the crowd to get him rattled there. Or would that be part of his psychology? Let Atlas think he's rattled.
He's yelling at the fans to shut up, shut up. He doesn't. The only way he'll get them to cool is go in the ring and start wrestling, I believe. Tony Atlas ready for him, and now they lock horns, so to speak. Which is Tony in the corner, and a clean break. All right, a new image, huh?
Well, absolutely. I've never seen him do that before. Clean break. No, I haven't seen that from Adrian Adonis before.
That's still the same old mean-looking face of the adorable one that used to be known as Adrian.
Yes, the blonde hair doesn't make him anymore.
Oh, he's
nicer looking, really.
Got a bad disposition. All right, he shoves Atlas in the corner again. Will they break in a clean fashion?
Yeah.
Oh.
Uh-huh. A scornful, mocking slap round the face.
And it was a very unusual slap.
And that is going to raise the roof of Tony Atlas very, very quickly. In fact, Atlas is fed up with all this now.
Atlas, you know, is all man, all macho, and he's he wants to put an end to this stuff. Oh, Adrian swings him into the corner. Now we'll see if it's a clean break again. Whoa, right. Ha, ha, ha. All right. Tony Atlas blocks the right hand of Adrian Adonis, the adorable one, and gives him a shot with the right.
Slapped him out of the right and what a slap. And nearly knocked his head off.
Well, and Tony Atlas has his hands as empty today. What's all this going on? Adonis is really upset.
Adrian's having another thought about this by the look of things, and he might decide to abandon these tactics and get right down to wrestling, because there's no doubt about it. Adrian can wrestle, and he can wrestle hard.
I don't think if he's out of the closet, as he says, I don't think he forgets old habits. And if I were Tony Atlas, I wouldn't be surprised if Adrian Adonis resorts to some old and proven holds on him. We'll find out. I'll tell you, the fans are really excited about this tournament. Side headlock by Atlas on Adonis. Watch the coiffure there, Tony. He takes it to the middle of the row, the ring, down on one knee. Side headlock. Ray Maliseki, the referee, putting his face up to Adonis, saying, all right, you all right? Or you give in? You submit? Probably not.
Those powerful arms of Atlas holding Adonis. He's not going to let him go now. At last, he's got him out of the corner into the middle of the ring.
Still maintaining that side headlock, Lord Alfred.
See if he hangs on again.
Yep. Oh, not a clean break. Brought the knee up. Now he puts a side headlock on Atlas. And Atlas takes him to the ropes. Oh, dodges him. Art. Oh. Whoa, flying headbutt. And Adonis over the top rope gets locked up with the second one. Woo!
I thought for one moment Adonis was going to come right into our laps there, Dick.
I was thinking maybe he's heading in your direction, and I like you, Alfred, but I would rather he did that than me.
Really? For one moment there, I thought Adonis was going to come out, but his experience showed he managed to cling hold of those top ropes and save himself a lot of punishment.
Well, Atlas reaches over the top rope with a side headlock, drags Atlas back in the ring again, and that's for the art in the center of the ring. Malasecki still checking things out. The hold satisfactory to him. No chokehold or anything like that, so we're in good shape, he says.
And once you're inside those powerful arms of Atlas like that, that's going to wear you right down.
I forget the... I should remember this because it's a very special guy, Atlas, but I forget how much he has pumped in the way of weight. Was it 500 pounds, 600 pounds?
I would imagine, yes.
Just
I would imagine.
A lot.
Yes.
Incredible.
Very powerful man.
Yeah.
Tremendously powerful.
Stays in shape as all good athletes.
Oh!
Nice maneuver by Adonis.
A back suplex there that knocked the wind out of Atlas, and he's struggling now.
He's stunned. And I'll tell you, Adonis doesn't look too much in good shape.
No, he doesn't look so much in
shape. Oh, double elbow smash on Tony Atlas by adorable Adrian.
And there was a lot more bite in that back suplex than I thought at first, because Atlas is still down there, and I thought he might be able to roll away from that maneuver by Adonis, but he wasn't. He was...
Well, nice.
Down and struggling.
Well, nice upper body maneuver and showing the energy, the depth of Atlas. He just picked up, in a sense, picked up Atlas and shoved him away. So there was a count, but not the count out.
Atlas is he's trying to get back some sort of semblance of what could you say, strength here, but it appears that Adonis has really dealt him a damaging blow with that very, very quick back suplex. And now Atlas is struggling hard, and I think he made the mistake of underestimating Adonis. I really do. Which is a shame.
Well, I wouldn't try to prove Tony Atlas wrong. All I said earlier was a guy like Adonis, you can change your name or your affectation, put it that way, but there's still the wrestler underneath. Man alive.
Oh my word.
Atlas didn't even twitch. If he saw it coming, one, two, and he just...
Superhuman determination there by Atlas to come out of that, because I thought he was down for one, two, three, four, five, six.
Well,
but he came out.
Adonis says to his fans, okay, just watch it. Here it comes. They're going to put him away this time. I think that's what he was indicating.
Uh-huh.
Maybe. Well, Atlas does a little reversal. Oh, catches it, going in.
Ran into that sleeper hold.
Oh, boy.
Ran right into it.
Adonis thinks he's got him, and maybe he does. Got him in a...
Now, this is
position.
Where this weight comes in.
Yeah.
He bends the man's head forward and uses all of that. Well, he's not using it now, but he did it first. And that was where he drives the man's head right down into his chest. However, it looks as if Donis thinks he can put him to sleep with this hole.
Maybe so. Malasecki, the referee, pulling the arm of Atlas upward and dropping it to see whether there's any... Oh!
Yeah.
Atlas is holding it up. He says, wait a minute. Don't drop that arm, because I'm not dropping it. Atlas looks a little bit disturbed right now.
Yeah. Atlas is saying, don't write me off yet.
I was reading the eyes. Atlas said, wait a minute. I thought I had him. Now he's coming back. Oh, my gosh. Now what? Well... Oh! Atlas, at the last minute, stopped. Adonis' body kept on going, the shoulder going into the top turnbuckle in that corner of the ring. He gives Atlas a shot in the midsection.
Right in the very beginning.
Right off the nose.
Atlas fell for that tremendous back suplex, and I feel sure that if he hadn't have done that, by this time Atlas would have had this match in the bag.
Well, he's going to where the 747s go, and maybe... This was a bad... Oh! Well, I think the picture tells the whole story, fans.
Don't say anything about that.
Commentary, no. He's going to make a boy soprano out of him. He'll hit all the high notes now. Oh, he says, does that smart, to say the least.
Atlas is allowing that referee to push him back. He should get in there and finish Adonis off. That's better.
Whoa, a headbutt. Adonis now flops into the ring again. It looks back, maybe payback time. Atlas Apri brings him to his feet. Smash across the side of the head by Atlas.
Powerful blow.
The top turnbuckle. I clear your mind, it clouded further. Headbutt. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Whoa!
Oh.
A flying, I don't know what you'd call it.
Flying headbutt, obviously, of some type.
Okay.
Yes,
two.
He's got him.
There goes the leg up on the middle rope, so that's the end of that. And Atlas got to have to drag him, what, in the middle of the ring? Get him away from those ropes.
Looks like he's going to turnbuckle him again.
Oh,
he does. Puts him in for that ride.
Oh, man. I'll tell you, Adonis is quick. And there's the foot on the top. One, two, and three. He's got him. Or she has him. Woo!
Oh, Atlas is disgusted with that, and he's taken off. But he was beaten, and he was beaten in no uncertain manner there by Adrian Adonis, the new Adrian Adonis, the adorable Adrian Adonis. And I'm afraid that's a very bad mark and record for him.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner, the adorable one, Adrian Adonis!
Well,
all right, let's get the replay, Lord Alfred. Here we go. Take him into the corner, and Tony quickly on top of him, but slams him in there, bruising the shoulder, right on top of him. The leg was over the bottom rope. Malasecki saw that, but he backs up and counts three again, and that's all she wrote. One, two, and it's all over. Well, fans, so much for the adorable one for the time being. Don't go away. There's more wrestling excitement direct to the Spectrum in South Philadelphia. But first, here's a preview of a fine movie on Prism this month.
Hello?
You're telling me a telephone killed the girl?
I'm leaning in that direction.
They can send a pulse so powerful, it will pierce your brain, explode your heart, and jolt you 10 feet off the ground. They're getting louder. They're getting closer. Bells, starring Richard Chamberlain, John Houseman, Sarah Botsford. The sound of fear. Bells.
Well, our fan of the month is here. He's in attendance. He's Mark Bidding from Levittown, Pennsylvania, Bucks County. He's with his friends Steve and Jim, Jay, and Matt. A bunch of good guys there. Congratulations, and enjoy the show, fellas. Now, if you want to be a fan of the month, if you're watching right now, drop us a line at Prism Wrestling, care of the Spectrum, Broad and Patterson Street, Philadelphia, 19148. Let me repeat. If you'd like to be considered a fan of the month, write to Prism Wrestling, care of the Spectrum, Broad and Patterson Street, Philadelphia, 19148. Well, Lord Alfred, the action is crazy. We've seen some unpredictable events. I'm going back to the last matchup, but
yeah.
It's very unpredictable. But we've got a big, big sellout crowd, 19,710 right here at the Spectrum watching the World Wrestling Federation. And I'll tell you, it continues. We've got two gentlemen, Oriental-type gentlemen. Let me put it that way. We won't say more. They're entering the ring now. Very worthy opponents. And we'll get the ring announcer to give us the introductions right now.
Here we go, wrestling fans. In this corner, 289 pounds from Korea. Here is Tiger Chung Lee. And in front of me, ladies and gentlemen, from the island of Tonga, 275 pounds, King Tonga!
All right. King Tonga from Tonga. And Tiger Chung Lee from Korea. And he is, He's got his eye on you, Lord Albert. he's going to have you after he has Tiger. He's going to after he has the tongue.
Oh, he had a few pieces of me before, don't worry. He's had a very checkered career, this Chong Lee, and I had some battles with him way back. And
he remembers them.
He remembers them, and I remember them.
I just
say,
so do you.
And I'd rather he'd be up there now and me down here to tell the truth.
And maybe that's what he was thinking. Maybe he sees himself in your chair someday.
Yes.
All right, they make contact against the rope, and clean break. Tonga Kid very well set up, sporting a rather imposing scar on the upper right shoulder. Hey, how do you like the maneuvers there? Talk about
very
quick.
Very quick.
Oh, man.
Very quick.
Chung Lee, though, is a very interesting, I'll tell you. He's not only the inscrutable Oriental, but the guy has a tremendous repertoire of moves.
And on his day, he is unbeatable.
Yeah.
He has been in there against the best, and he's beaten the best as well. So if King Tonga does anything against Chung Lee, for one, I'll be a little bit surprised, and I'll certainly take my hat off to him.
Well, any day you step in the ring, Lord Albert, it's not an off day.
That's true. It better not be, anyway.
Yeah. Oh! Chung Lee shows us a nice body slam. There's a drop kick or kick out by the Tonga Kid. And pressure on the arm now, Tiger Chung Lee.
King Tonga certainly knows his wrestling. He knows his way around this mat, as he showed us just then. Brilliant series of moves there. Either man could have come out on top, but it was King Tonga.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'll ask you, I guess we can slide a question in. Maybe we can do it while the action's a little bit slack right now. How much have the holds changed? Now, you started a little while back in wrestling, but I mean, the present day, you've got younger guys and maybe more agile than, I don't mean to say you weren't agile, but I mean, they're young guys on vitamins and all sorts of health situations. They're into bodybuilding and all that. Maybe more so than you guys were.
Definitely.
Early.
Now, there's no doubt about that. Nutrition, they know a lot more than we did.
Yeah.
And I tell you, the biggest change is this, Dick, that when I was wrestling at my peak, say, about 5 or 6 years ago, it has changed, because now you're getting men 6'7", 6'6", and there weren't those big fellows about that time. It's just like football. Now look at the size of those offensive lines and defensive linemen, and they're just huge. They're mammoths.
You know, they seem to keep getting bigger and bigger.
Yes, and they are alert and sharp and very,
and
very quick.
They're quick.
Now, look at our world champion now.
Oh.
Just look at him.
Oh,
6'10", 300 pounds, there's not an ounce of fat on him.
That's right.
And he is the greatest there's ever been.
Well, you know, I remember when Hogan first came up here at the Spectrum about 5 years ago, maybe, something like that, 6 years. And I remember doing some interviews with him. And you know, his weight, I don't think he's buried more than a pound or two here and there.
No.
He's in excellent shape.
No.
Doesn't go up, doesn't go down, he kind of stays the same.
No, they know everything there is to know about training now. They do it scientifically.
Yep.
They read books on it.
They know how to build up certain portions of the body, the whole thing.
Yes, they know when to rest. They know when to work out. They just know it all now. It's a lot different from when I was, as I say, at my prime, which was, say, between 5 and 10 years ago.
Well, times have changed, and Donald, we'll see another 5 or 10 years when it comes to these guys.
they may change again. I can't see it, though, can you?
No,
how can they possibly get bigger and better than they are now?
I'm sure they will somehow. All right, Tiger Chung Lee takes down the Tonga Kid with a kick to the midsection. And works on him, another kick to the midsection. Maybe he's going to try to wear him down. They've been going back and forth here a little bit. And kicks right to the face now, not the midsection. So he's down on, on ball fours, suffice it to say. Snap mare, down he goes. Knee to the midsection. It looks like a brawl now. It looks like Tiger Chung Lee's just going to manhandle him.
You know, we've had a lot of Polynesian wrestlers who've been very, very good wrestlers over the years. This King Tonga is comparatively a newcomer here into the ranks of the WWF, and for that matter, right here in America itself. But he's proving to be possibly having the prospect of being one of the best Polynesian wrestlers of all time. I like King Tonga's looks. I like his determination. He's got a lot of willpower, a lot of energy, but most of all, he's got a lot of heart.
Well, you've said it all, I think, because all those ingredients are certainly essential for the complete man, complete wrestler. Well, there's it working on the chin of Tonga Kid, and Tiger Chung Lee is still adding pressure. It's a nice arm drag takedown by Tonga. Whoa! Shoulder block, and down goes. Tiger Chung Lee catches him with a knee as he had that momentum coming off the ropes. The Tonga Kid goes down like a a sack of potatoes.
Yeah, a little bit of an experience there, because he's up against Chung Lee, who's had years and years of experience, a punishing wrestler, as we said before, and on his day, he's capable of beating the best, and he has considerable opposition for anybody. Knows his karate, knows all the moves. Right now, Tonga has lost that little impetus he had. Let's see if he can get it back.
Chung Lee's been doing a series of knees to the midsection or the side of the body of the Tonga kid, and again, he's just really trying to beat him down, is what I can see. He's still working on the head, just wringing that neck periodically. Tonga kid trying to get it on. He's now back up on both of his feet.
When we started out this match, Chung Lee was running around at just a tremendous speed. So King Tonga has definitely slowed him down a bit.
For sure.
But at the same time, King Tonga himself, some tremendous karate chops as I was talking there. But King Tonga also seems to have slowed down a bit. So they've taken a lot of the steam out of each other, these two.
Well, they have. And I see that Tonga Kid did a little quick maneuver and gave a shot to the face, the head, and now a kick to the midsection, another knee to the midsection of Tiger Chung Lee. So the Tiger Kid, you say he's determined. He really is. He keeps coming at you. Well, we have seen trouble time and time again where a guy gets eager, goes into the corner for the guy, and all of a sudden nobody's home.
Nobody was home there, and I just get that feeling that Chung Lee is trying to tempt King Tonga into some situations where the king thinks he's going to just do it, and he has not been able to so far. Chung Lee showing a lot of good experience. He's a veteran wrestler.
But no decisive maneuvers, really.
Not been able to pin him down, has he?
No.
Not been able to.
Really has not gone in one specific direction.
No, you've got to put two or three maneuvers together, two or three holds together, and stay with them. And Chung Lee, to my amazement here, he hasn't really done that against King Tonga. Maybe he can't.
Well, it's we're not seeing the fast-paced action that maybe we had anticipated earlier, but Tonga Kid is in bad shape. He's in the corner and being worked over now by Tiger Chung Lee. A snapmare takedown, and he's right on top of him.
Yeah. They started out so fast, Dick, I think they've really taken the steam out of each other here.
They may have burned the one another out.
Yes, uh-huh. And now it's coming down to a question of brute strength almost.
It may be who can just outlast the other, although for the time being I see that Tiger Chung Lee is definitely in command.
Yes, but you know, King Tonga is a young wrestler, and he's got that staying power of young wrestlers, whereas Chung Lee is beginning to get up there a little bit age-wise. I don't mean he's old or anything like that, but sometimes that younger man will have the staying power a lot better.
Well, there's a body slam, and now Tiger Chung Lee to the top ropes. Now he's going to be taking a body slam.
Ooh.
He took about 6 feet off the ground and smashed to the ring floor. Whoa! And there's a lot of weight coming down on your head and neck area, your chest. Tonga Kid in a roll right now. Forearm smash. Takes him to the ropes. Dive back body drop. Oh yeah. He was about five feet high then. There's a head butt. Down he goes. And he locks him up, pulls the leg. And that's all she wrote. A turnabout if I ever saw it.
King Tonga there. He stuck with what he was going to do. The opportunity arose and he took full advantage of that, and that's a mark of a good wrestler. This King Tonga, we're going to see a lot more of him, I'm sure.
Well, let's get the official announcement now from Frankie Talley.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner, King Tonga!
Well, Tonga had himself a real workout, and of course, so did Tiger Chung Lee. I wasn't too sure that we were really. Now here comes the replay. Takes him off the top rope, and he came about 6 feet from the air.
Good height, height. And here Tonga comes down, drops that leg on him very heavily, right on the chin. He doesn't waste any time. Picks him up again, hits him right flush to the jaw, throws him
comes
in.
The back body drop.
Whoa! Big back body drop. Now watch the height he gets.
He got
with
right
his
on him though. Look, he got right on him. Zap.
And well, you can't do much about that.
1, 2, 3, and that's all she wrote, and Dusty Feldbaumer counts him out. Well, coming right up is the main event. It's a handicapped tag team match, fans, as Andre the Giant and Hulk Hogan battle a threesome consisting of Big John Studd, King Kong Bundy, and Bobby the Brain Heenan, if you will.
She was an art student. She had the power to see things beyond the normal range of human senses. She saw murder. She was cursed with a terrifying talent. She became a silent witness. It started as a game and turned into a nightmare.
All right, fans, to the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we continue with tonight's card of wrestling, I would like to take this opportunity to remember a man who not only was the voice of the 76ers, but a man who graced this very squared circle for the World Wrestling Federation and made announcements of matches as only he can do. A man who truly indeed is a Philadelphia institution. We would like all of you to please rise in a moment of silence as we shall have a 10 bell moratorium salute for the Zinc, the one and the only Dave Zinkoff.
Mel Phillips was very eloquent in that brief tribute to the late Zink, the Zinker, Dave Zinkoff, 76ers announcer and friend to everybody. He loved everybody that loved him. And I'll tell you, when I came down here tonight, Lord Alfred Hayes, I knew that he would not be here, and I miss him, and the guy's just been great. I never saw him at a time when he wasn't friendly, had a smile for everybody, a handshake, a pat in the back, encouraging people. Great man, we will miss him.
You can bet your life he's here in spirit.
He is. All right, fans, does it ever stop? No, 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 not in the World Wrestling Federation. And here we have a cast of characters. I always said, Albert, would you buy a used car from one of these guys?
I don't know about that, but could they get into a used car? One of those guys? The size of them. Just look at them.
Well, we haven't seen anything. This place got to come apart at the seams. All this sellout crowd of 19,710 people in attendance when the Hulker and Andre make the scene, and they are not here yet. But wait
Ladies
a moment.
And gentlemen, the manager of the year with Bundy, the Giant, Scott. How do y'all like it?
Predictably.
The world of wrestling has never, ever seen anything the likes of Hogan, especially with him teaming up with Andre the Giant. How impressive, how awesome, how absolutely incredulous.
I'll tell you, man, and Heenan is strangely silent outside the ring.
I should think so. After that tremendous right hander caught him right on the chops and floored him.
Well, funny thing, Stud was trying to get out of his robe, so Andre very kindly went around and helped him out, holding his arms.
Well, yes,
while the
yes.
Hawker
you
gave him a shot
that.
In the head. Well, Bill Phillips is going to try to introduce these wrestlers.
The following is a special tag team handicap match scheduled for one fall with a 1 hour time limit. Introducing team number one, first from Beverly Hills, California, weighing 246 pounds, Bobby the Brain Heenan.
The manager of the year.
From Atlantic.
We have to correct that, Bobby Heenan. You are the Wizzle of the year.
Woo! From Atlantic City, New Jersey, weighing in at 453 pounds, King Kong Bundy. And from Los Angeles, California, at 364 pounds, Big John Studd. The opponents, first from Venice Beach, California, weighing in at 305 pounds, the World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, Hulk Hogan. And his tag team partner from Grenoble in the French Alps, at 525 pounds, Andre the Giant.
I just cannot hear myself think here. This place is absolutely alive. The charisma of Hulk Hogan and Andre the Giant has grabbed hold of everybody, pulled them up out of their seats, and the whole place is electric.
They really are, man. I think everybody's, they're just starting to sit down now. They've been standing for the past 5 minutes. Well, I don't think the young Joe Morella, he has his hands full as the, well, third man or fifth man, as you will, in the square circle.
I think he's about the sixth man.
He might be. He might be.
He, Dick? But
well, it looks to be Andre and Big John Studd are going to start it off.
And look at Andre the Giant smiling. Oh, he's just going to love this. He is absolutely going to adore this.
Well, they have never lacked for animosity, and Andre and Big John Studd, of course, have disliked one another for a long time. And now we see another competition here at the Spectrum before a sellout crowd of 19,710 excited wrestling fans. This is Sports City, Philadelphia.
And here is John Studd's chance to prove that he is the only true giant, but he's not looking like that, is he, Dick?
No, not at all. Whoa. Whoa. A little bit of a sight job for... Andre has a hand, big as your foot, and he's moving Big John Studd around the ring. Look at this. You believe it?
Oh, off he goes.
A slam! A body slam on Big John Studd! Are you ready for that?
Oh, that must have been 10 feet in the air then. The Giant just whipped him up as easy as anything, 300, almost 400 pounds, and slammed him in the very center of the ring and shook the whole foundations of this arena.
John Studd looked at you and me, indicating he had him by the tights or something. Well, I don't know if he did or not, but he did slam him, and that's for doggone sure.
I don't think Studd will take another one of those. I don't think he can survive another one of those.
Well,
no wonder he survived this one.
The tag is made, and the Hawkster's in now, getting a word from Andre as Big John Studd returns to the ring. And the Hawkster says, Maybe it's my turn to slam you. Maybe not.
You can tell the size of these big men in the ring. Stubb just stepped over the top rope there quite easily, quite nonchalantly.
Well,
the top rope must be about 5.5 feet, 6 feet high.
Well, just about. These guys are leaning over it. They're all right, they go for the head, they lock horns to the ring, and now, oh, takes the Hulkster into the ring ropes here. Oh!
Another slam! Another big, big slam!
Oh. Woo. The fans are coming to their feet again.
Look at the Hulkster, he's watching him.
He's doing the junkyard dog. He's got a maneuver right for the junkyard dog, and I'm telling you, Stud has had it.
I tell you something, Dick. If John Stud survives this, I don't think the ring will. That is just a tremendous
Well, thing. Bobby the Brain is in bad part of the town right now.
Whoa! Oh.
He had been.
God. That was jet propulsion.
And now Bundy's out.
He's all cleared the ring. Hulk has swept house there. He swept them right off.
Well, Big John Studd's down on one knee right in front of our broadcast location. On the other side of the ring, Bundy is ministering to Bobby the Brain Heenan. And the brain went over the top rope, man, like he was shot out of a gun.
Really, and Hulk Hogan appealed to referee, don't count him out, he said. Let us finish them off inside the ring. He doesn't want such a quick, easy victory.
That's it.
He wants to make them pay.
He does. Well, now it's Studd over the top rope again, just literally walking over it.
I'm surprised he's up on his feet after those two slams. You got to remember, these big men, they weigh so heavy, when they come down, that shakes them to the back. Here goes Bundy.
Here's a challenge. Can anybody body slam this man? I wonder.
Boy, he's close to 500 pounds.
I know. What are we talking about?
The most awesome figure.
453 pounds. Oh, no, we got a psych job going. Bundy,
that'll show you. The Hulk is 300.
Oh!
A high knee's got him covered. He's down there. And Heenan saved
him.
Yes, yeah, no, hey, hey.
Oh,
my word.
Now Heenan.
A heavy boot to the head.
He caught the weight of Bundy up on top of, on the shoulders of Hulk Hogan and pushed that weight backward. We almost had a pinning situation.
And Bundy going to work on Hulk Hogan, kicking him in the head, laying that full 450 pounds on him, not giving him a chance. And here he comes for a splash.
Oh, nobody home. Tag made. Hulk out. Andre in.
What's Andre going to do? Give him the big boot?
He caught the big boot.
Yes.
Right in the midsection. And here's Andre, Lord Alfred, gets to be vulnerable.
Yes.
He's down.
These are the two biggest men in the whole of professional wrestling.
For sure.
And here's the third one.
And here's John Studd now doing his thing. Double chop on the back of Andre. Andre leaning against the bottom rope. And Hulk Hogan takes a smash at the Hulkster. Well, it's payback time here now.
Yeah, the Stud is putting those big boots and that big arm to work.
Andre has the big boot of the giant, Big John Stud. Andre's in the bad part of town. He's got to make a tag. I don't know how, but and now what Bundy has done is block off any retreat Andre could make to break the tag with the Hulkster. They're right on the ring ropes. They got a break.
Andre in a lot of trouble here with these two big men.
He really is.
Now Heenan wants to come in. Now he sees a chance to put the boots through the giant while the giant is fairly defenseless.
Heenan better tag somebody, man.
Oh, the giant has just cleared his throat, Dick.
Heenan was glad to get out of there, man. Heenan the Cowardly Lion.
Yes, that wasn't the place for Heenan to be.
No, man, he knew it. He thought he had something going, but now he knows he doesn't. Here's a bear hug on Stud by Andre, but a tag is made on Bundy.
And Stud kept Andre turned around so he couldn't see Bundy coming in.
Joe Morella. Okay, high came off.
Uh-oh, something going to happen here. The big boot!
He caught him right in the head. And now the huckster says, now it's my turn, Turkey.
Oh, this will move the ring. Right off. Oh!
Bundy.
Oh, head first down goes Bundy. Oh, look at the hole. He's gone absolutely berserk.
All right, Bundy gave Hulk a knee in the midsection, gives him an elbow, and down he goes. Here's the tag made. Stud in. Bundy getting out eventually.
All these 19,000 people here are right behind the Hulk.
For sure.
Urging him on. He managed to kick out of that, but that was getting close to it. Hulk has taken a lot of punishment now. When you take a hit from these big men, they really
are.
Oh, my word.
Hulkster really had a body slam to end all body slams at the hands of Big John Studd. And he hit that floor. He's crawling in the wrong direction. He doesn't know where he is.
The world champion is down there, and Bundy and Sutter are making the most of it. And well, they should, or well, they might, because this opportunity might never arise again.
Two. Oh! Boy. Young Morella, the referee's hand was raised, almost came down to the count of three on Hulk Hogan at the hands of Bundy. King Kong Bundy, what a massive flick. What a big man he is, and a real bad stud.
Just listen to these people come alive here.
Well, they're trying to transfer their energy, their adoration to the Hulkster. I don't know, man.
They want to give him that mental encouragement to make him get that physical strength up, and they're doing it.
Well, the Hulkster raises his hand and says, I'm number one.
And they're going to do
it.
Here
I come.
They're going to win this belt for the Hulk. And for Andre.
Shoulder block. Another shoulder block. He's wobbling. Whoa. He takes down the Hulkster. Man alive, this guy is massive.
He is a big, big, awesome man.
Tag made, stood in.
And it's unusual to see the Hulk not knock anybody down with the first tackle, let alone two or three.
Well, John Studd, now it's his turn to work a lot on the Hulkster. Count of two. Hulk is spotting a couple of band-aids over his right eye. Came in the ring with him. Shoulder block takedown by Big John Studd on the Hulkster. One, two, oh! You talk about close.
You've got to hand it to Hulk here. He's taken the brunt of all this attack from two of the biggest men in the world, and he's still there. He's still hanging in.
Well,
desperately, but he's going to do it, Dave.
Well, the tag is made, Lord Alfred. And finally, Hulk's getting the treatment from Bundy, and he in the whip.
And he has got to get out of that corner no matter what happens.
Boy, Andre, look, he says, hey, man. Hey, look on the other side of the ring, referee. There's two on one, man. There's the tag made. Here comes Heenan.
Heenan wants his piece of Hulk as well, and this could be Heenan's undoing.
But only on his term.
Really? Uh-oh.
Oh!
No matter how down the Hulk is, he can still deal with Heenan very, very easily. Now he's putting it together.
Yeah.
Now the Hulk is going to get it together. He's shaking his head, and this crowd are willing him to get back on his feet.
Oh, ho, ho. Uh-oh.
Now look at his face.
He has made a mistake or two, has Bobby the Brain Heenan. Heenan's, Heenan says, I believe. Wait, can we take a timeout, please? Just a second. Let's talk. Woof. And the fans are eating this alive. Bobby the Brain, not much of a hero to the people here at the Spectrum, the sellout crowd. The tag is going to be made. Bobby the Brain, oh my heaven.
Oh, backhander from the Giants.
He says my insurance paid up.
Humiliation first before they do something to him. Look out, Giants.
Oh!
Look out, it comes Bundy. And I hope they're all ring. All in.
Oh, they got them all three in the corner. Hawk takes him to the top turnbuckle. The pad already taken off.
Big boot to Heenan's jaw. And he's never going to move the giant.
All she wrote. All she wrote.
The people here are deliriously happy. They love the fact that Andre the Giant and the Hulk have been victorious here. And it was quite a strain and a struggle for them. But they overcame all that deficit that they had to face in three men. And they wound up winning this match.
All right, let's go to Mel Phillips to get the decision.
Here are your winners. The team of Andre the Giant and the World Heavyweight Champion, Hulk Hogan.
Everybody on their feet here. 20,000 people. And John Stoddard's made another mistake.
And it's still,
the Hulk is doing life tight.
It's still on, man.
Andre just cannot get out of that. He's on the edge of the ring. And they're going to splash the Hulk. They're going to hold him and they're going to splash him and the giant can't get from it.
But Andre's loose.
They'll put him out of wrestling if they do that again. Andre's back in there. And John Studd is bailing out and so is the other big man, Bundy, and Heenan too. But they got one damaging splash in on Hulk Hogan.
It remains to be seen how well Hogan comes back for that. You talk about that's a cheap shot to end all cheap shots, man. Andre over with Hulk Hogan now, although the decision has been made, they won by a pin, but still, after the fact, the cheap shots by Bobby the Brain, Big John Studd, and King Kong Bundy. Well,
they waited there.
Let's watch the events leading up to Arn Alfred to the pin. Here we go. Now there's Andre taking Heenan into the corner. He moves Studd in there and goes after Bundy. So they're all there in one corner. And
Hulk
there's a headbutt. All right, we saw the headbutt of Andre on Studd. Now here,
big boot.
A size 15 or 16 hitting old Heenan.
He's never going to push the giant out from there.
Well, Hulk Hogan's coming off to our right, and he's in bad shape. Oh, boy. Well, fans, as the excitement settles, Prism is your channel for movies, specials, and sports. And here's just a preview.
The initials VBK, synonymous with a man himself, Van Breedekoff, Butch Van Breedekoff. And all this month, Prism's Jim Barniak talks with this wonderful weaver of basketball stories on Sports Scrapbook. Butch Van Breedekoff, he's had almost every coaching job in basketball. Colleges, big and small, the ABA, the NBA, the high schools. He has coached superstars and legends. Relive the coaching career of Butch Van Breedekoff this month on Jim Barniak's Sports Scrapbook, exclusively on Prism.
Well, the World Wrestling Federation's done it again. 19,710 screaming wrestling fans here at the Spectrum, Lord Alfred Hayes, and I'm telling you, they're enjoying every second of it, as we are.
Yes, I love it, Dick. You know, we discussed it before. It's been almost a year since I was last here, and they certainly haven't lost their enthusiasm. In fact, I think it's only got more and more enthusiastic since I was last here.
Well, I think you can truthfully say enthusiastic because we've got two Jesse the Body Ventura lookalikes here at ringside.
I saw them.
They were
good.
Yeah. And we have, we've got so many people ringside with signs of all kinds for and against various wrestlers. I'll tell you, man, they're into it. They're having a lot of fun. And 19,000 more people can't be wrong. They really, Philadelphia fans are great, and they really love their action, and they get it right here at the Spectrum.
And they know their wrestling from A to Z.
Yes, they do.
Oh, you say A to Z, don't you?
A to Z in this country. In the colonies here, Lord Alfred, we say Z.
They certainly know their wrestling here, and so, and the WWF gives them the best there is anyway.
Wish you give them a jolly good show.
Yes. I mean, the wrestlers they have nowadays, they're just unnatural, aren't they? I mean,
well, we've got the British Bulldogs coming along here shortly, but right now, here's a guy who's really to be reckoned with. And we'll get the introduction to him in just a minute. Well, the fans are getting cranked up.
This man's beginning to make a big, big impression in wrestling circles, not only here in this country, but all around the world, of course, and that is the World Wrestling Federation, because it does travel around the world. But where he has made his biggest impression is with the Hart Foundation.
Well, he has that, and I'll tell you, he's got a formidable opponent coming into the ring right now, and Polish power reigns supreme tonight.
And this man has already made his impression.
Polish power!
Would you say he was a little modest, or a little shy, or a little uncertain of himself? Not at all, huh?
First, in the corner to my right, from Calgary, Alberta, Canada, weighing in at 235 pounds, representing one half of the Hart Foundation, Bret Hitman Hart. And from Krakow, Poland, weighing in at 243 pounds, Polish power, Ivan Putski.
He's a trip, isn't he? Isn't he beautiful?
Oh, isn't he?
Everybody's Polish when, it's just like everybody's Irish on St. Patty's Day, and everybody's Polish when he comes in to wrestle it. But you know, he's so relaxed. He comes in here, and boy, looks like nothing bothers him. He waves to the fans, gives them the old thumbs up, and hi, how are you, gang? And he's everybody's friend, except when you get him angry.
Yes, and you know, Polish is just like polish, and he has a lot of polish, doesn't he?
He certainly does.
Look at him.
Look at him.
He's ready already.
He says, man, I fear no man. And Hitman says, hey, take care of my shades, my good man. He's well set up. You can't take this guy lightly. It's Hitman Hart, tell you. There's Putski putting on the referee, doing a little bit of a shuffle a la a boxing.
he's ready to punch out Bret Hart, the Hitman. But he's not going to beat Bret Hart that way.
Hart has no sense of humor. Looks like you bite glass and chew it. Ah, look at Ivan. He's so cool. Look at him. Is he cool? The fans love him. They're all on Hart's case. They're all dumping on him tonight. All right, they make contact. Oh, look at that. Putski.
He has the power.
Hart saying to referee Dusty Felbar, he went for my hair. Get out of here.
There's
Ivan.
Plenty of power there.
Look. He's giving it. Don't you love it, fans? I mean, really. He's so cool. Ivan says, all right, down to business. All right. If you want to play, we'll play. Slide headlock. Cranks. No, he cranks a little bit more. Hart down to 1B. Hair pull, he gives him a shot in the face. Hart went for the hair on Putski. He said, wait a minute, man. I don't go that route. Side headlock again. Ivan cranking, he cranks him.
Putski having everything his own way at the moment. Hart doesn't seem to be too effective.
He's got his back to him. Looks like he's just cranking that head. Trying to take it off, maybe.
Hart is a notoriously slow starter, though. Yeah. He seems to need about 5 or 10 minutes before he can really get his adrenaline flowing. And
well, I hope he can wait that long.
I'm going to say that may be too long in this case.
Well, side headlock again. Putski says, "Shall I give him a shot with a fist?" He's taking the fans on. Now, Putski says, no, I gave him the heel of my hand, Mr. Referee.
Just look at Putski, not a hair out of place yet. Not a bead of sweat.
And the Hitman says, man, my head says you didn't use the open hand, he used a fist. Well, let's be friends, he says. Let's be friends. Let's get along. Let's be nice. And Ivan says, come on, I've been around too long for that one. Side headlock again. Hitman strikes, and Ivan Putski delivers a flying elbow. He's a very workmanlike individual, this guy, Hitman Hart, as you can see now. And the honeymoon may be over for Ivan Putski right now.
Well, once Brett gets moving, he's all business.
Yes, he is. He really, look, he's very businesslike. Just Very methodical.
No, he won't allow himself to be distracted by the crowd either once he gets moving.
Well, he went across the eyes, break the eyes of Ivan Putski. Polish Power is on hold right now.
Yeah, well, I'm afraid Ivan was taking him too lightly in the beginning there. Yeah. And that seems to have suited Bret Hart because he's come alive and he's come alive with a vengeance.
I'll tell you, he's really a strong individual. A lot of power there, youth. Oh, ho! Coming right across the back. Putski down. One, two, and look at that upper body strength of Putski. He literally picked him up and shoved him.
There's the Polish Power.
He went right through all that pain and really disposed of Hitman Hart for the time being.
You know, 12 months ago, Hart, although a good wrestler, was pretty ineffectual. But since Jimmy Hart, the Mouth of the South, has taken him into his little family, you might say, with the Anvil, they've taught him to be ruthless, they've taught him to be a killer, and he's a vastly improved technician also.
I wonder where the Mouth of the South is. He should be here supporting.
Oh, please, yeah. Please don't let him around with that horrible megaphone.
Oh, I know. Last month he's been here, tried to do a number on Monsoon and myself, and that old megaphone. And I think Monsoon had eyes to take it and crack it.
I just hope he's not around because that thing is will drive you absolutely nuts.
He's like a precocious kid, you know?
Oh, isn't he? Awful. What he's done for the Hart Foundation, though.
Yeah, you can't argue that. Putski is on a tear right now against Hitman Hart. Gonna take a side headlock on him. Uh-huh. Down goes Hart. And Putski, again, it's payback time for him. Just, shall I give him a shot, fans? Yeah. Right into the top. Ivan now is very businesslike, but he plays with fans. He said, fans, tell me what I should do. Right off the top turnbuckle, Lord Alfred.
Yes, I don't think the fans have to tell Putski what to do. When he's
karate
on the move
chop.
Like this, he knows what to do.
Well, that's a karate chop right to the Adam's apple. Brought him right on. Right into the ring, turnbuckles. Uh-oh. Got Putski. One,
feet
two.
On the ropes there.
Oh,
and the referee didn't see it.
Putski was saying, hey.
We've got to have a look at that again sometime.
Yes, we
before going to.
And Hart very definitely had his feet hooked over the bottom rope in that corner.
Because there was no way he was going to keep Putski down this early in a fight. Because Putski wasn't winded, he wasn't knocked senseless. He had full control of all his faculties and strength, so there had to be a way of Hart keeping his shoulders down, and that was with his feet on the ropes.
Well, let's get the official announcement.
Here is your winner, Bret Hitman Hart.
Oh, Ivan says no, man. It is not over yet. Get out of my way. Well, whoo. And Hart,
Polish Hammer.
Hart rolls out and he bails out. I mean, Ivan is really, to say he's upset is not even describing it properly. He's incensed. He's bugged with the referee for the referee not having seen the bottom legs, the feet, if you will, of Hitman Hart over the bottom rope while the pinning was going on.
Well, the referee was partially unsighted there because he did have...
Well, he was looking for the shoulders.
Exactly. And Putski was right in his face anyway, so the only way he could count those shoulders was to block out the view of anything else.
All right, let's watch it, fans. Fans, judge for yourself now. Here we go. Putski catches it. Down he goes. Now watch the legs. All right. Now, the referee looking down. As far as the fans are concerned, Putski won. Well, fans, we're going to be right back with a special match. I'm talking about Ricky Steamboat against the magnificent one, Don Morocco.
Indiana Jones, pursued by Belloc. Befriended by Selena, threatened by Toad, and loved by Mary. They are all...
Look out!
Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Robert Hayes and yours truly, Dick Graham, ringside, World Wrestling Federation, at a sold-out Spectrum for Spectrum Professional Wrestling. And I'm telling you, the place is just jumping. You thought it was exciting the last few minutes. What we saw, well, to say the least, Hitman Hart give it to Andre Putski. Putski on the short end of a decision. Anyway, we're getting ready for the next event. And this is something else that I have. Mr. Fuji, replete with bowler, if you will. Hey, how about that?
How about that?
Bowler.
I like the word replete.
Replete. Replete. Resplendent in his attire. With a cane, a bag of devious tricks. Don Morocco there looking pretty good, looking a little bit agitated. He's, he's bugged. Why am I being kept waiting here by the likes of Ricky Steamboat? No love lost there from last month.
Absolutely not. You know, Don Morocco is not only a fantastic wrestler, but he is one of the most powerful men in the ranks of wrestling, and he is going against one of the most adept of all wrestlers, and that, of course, is the Black Dragon.
No question about that, Lord Alfred. And we have some very special music, and that's preparing the fans for the entrance to the Spectrum proper of the Steamboat Kid, if I call him Ricky.
Is a special kung fu match scheduled for one fall to a finish. In this bout, there can be no countouts and no disqualifications. Introducing first the manager from Osaka, Japan, Mr. Fuji. He represents from Sunset Beach, Hawaii, weighing 268 pounds, the magnificent Morocco. The opponent hails from Honolulu, Hawaii, weighing 238 pounds, Ricky, the Dragon Steamboat.
Lord Alfred, I think Steamboat looks to me like a man on with a mission against Don Morocco.
Yes, he has that intensity written all over his face. But before Morocco puts that jacket on, just look at his upper body. You can see strength surging through that body.
Yeah, for sure.
He is a powerful, powerful man. I think he's going to be at some disadvantage, though, if he's going to have to wear that karate jacket.
Well, it's a karate match. He's going to have to wear it. He tossed the bundle, the clothing bundle, if you will, at Don Morocco. It fell to the floor, and Steamboat pointed down, saying, pick it up. You got to wear it.
Well, that's the contract he signed, and and he's going to have to wear it.
Well, Morocco is looking with disdain.
He's probably feeling now, I made a mistake. Yeah, how did my manager get me into this?
He said, what are these threads I have to wear? And, well, looks like, oh, they fit, kind of, all right. I was wondering if things are going to fit him at all. He's a big man.
Yes, he is a big man.
He's being fitted now, the belt, by Mr. Fuji. Fuji knows of these things.
Oh, Fuji himself is just a tremendous martial arts expert. And I don't think for one moment he hasn't imparted all that knowledge to the magnificent one.
I know he has. Well, Morocco bows to Fuji, and, well, is he going to bow to
the dragon? So. He's not going to bow to the dragon, no.
Whoa! Fuji grabs a handful of lapel, if you will, or rather steamboat, and a couple of rolls, and he's down.
They were a couple of karate or judo throws. They were more like judo throws than karate, but he hit him with that karate chop to start with. I don't think...
Morocco's not liking this.
No. Saying,
I think fans, I think I goofed. Somewhere, somebody advised me incorrectly.
I think they did, too.
There's Steamboat on a tear. Whoa! Bring the eyes down from the top of the forehead, right across the... whoa!
Morocco seems nonplussed by this jacket as well. He doesn't seem to know what to do exactly.
He doesn't seem
free or able to move his arms or his
hands. I think when you're used to wrestling in tights as he is, without any leg wrappings or anything, I think he just feels encumbered, I would imagine.
And that is a stranglehold, and he's going to cut off the blood supply to his head. If, mind you, Morocco's got a fantastically thick neck, and I don't think you could shut off those carotid.
He's got a real bag of tricks, too. I noticed that his right thumb, as well as the fingers, are all taped up, as usual. So he's got sort of a spike there. Oh, he brings Morocco down, crashing the head off, his head off the ring floor. And Don is saying, Morocco's saying to the referee, hey, he's choking me, man, he's choking me. Young Joe Morella is the third man in the circle.
But there's no disqualification here, Dick, he can say that as long as he likes, and the referee's not going to do anything about it.
No count out, nothing. Whoa! And there, turnabout by Don Morocco, but Steamboat turns it around again. He's right back again on that hold. Now his back is toward us. As we get the camera, our ringside cameraman gets another view of this for us, and he's just choking some of the wind from Morocco, it looks to be.
Mr. Fuji is strutting up and down the side of this ring here. He's beginning to get a little bit worried for his protege, as well he might.
Whoa! Nice elbow maneuver by Don Morocco. A forearm to the back of the head on Ricky Steamboat, the Dragon. And the Dragon stunned a little bit, take him into the turnbuckle. Don Morocco, Steamboat was ready for that. Don Morocco was going to roll him. Here we go. Back.
He's just dragging Morocco all over the place like a doll.
Well, that's the jacket for you. Are you talking about a guy who's agile? Look at that. The Dragon's aptly named. A lot of fans at ringside tonight and in the arena here at the Spectrum. All for Ricky Steamboat. Not too many for Don Morocco, quite honestly.
And the Steamers has gone back to that original hold. He's going to wear down the neck of Don Morocco and hope to get a submission. Possibly hope to put him right out.
You try to anticipate sometimes. You think you're seeing something developing, but I wouldn't count Morocco out, really. Steamboat notwithstanding. Whoa! Morocco literally stood up. He moved the Dragon to his shoulders, literally stood up, and then back body dropped him.
My word, that was just a tremendous effort on the part of Morocco there. Morocco suffered a little bit from it himself, but nowhere near as much as the Black Dragon.
He brought that knee down right around the sternum area of Ricky Ricky Steamboat.
He's coming over for some martial arts advice from Mr. Fuji. They're going to get together. Oh, Morocco's taking off, is he? No, he's going to try and get a chair.
He wants the chair.
Well, he's not going to get disqualified because that was the rules that were laid down in this.
Oh, there's a clothesline maneuver by Don Morocco.
And Mr. Fuji is telling him to do something with that chair. What is he going to do?
Well,
he's setting that chair up in a particular fashion.
Oh, yeah, he has.
I get the feeling he's going to try and pile drive him on that chair. He's going to slam him on that chair. Oh, my word. Oh, he did pile drive him right into the metal part of the chair.
Gave him the pile driver, and right down he went. And Mr. Fuji is delighted.
He is delighted. So is Don Morocco, but I'm afraid the Black Dragon is suffering just intensely, Brad. He dropped him, pile-drived him right on the metal part of the chair. That was just one nasty, nasty blow there, and it was a very, very damaging move by Don Morocco. And the Black Dragon is suffering.
Well,
and he's bleeding as well. It looks as if the chair has opened up his head there,
Looks
Jim.
Like it has, yeah. Steve Bolt is vibrating. Steve Bolt is just vibrating from head to toe. He's taking terrible pounding. I don't know what's keeping him up. I know the ring ropes are right now, but a moment ago he was just barely standing. I don't know how he stood, but the blood cascading down his face from the forehead. And Don Morocco is very methodically taking the Dragon apart.
And he's taking his time doing it, too.
And he gives him a clothesline. The Dragon outside the ring now on the apron. They'll take him into the top. Oh, he takes him into the ring post. Slams his head against the top of that metal post. And look at it, there's a close-up.
He is in a serious way now, the Dragon. His eyes are closed. I don't know whether that's some sort of meditation to try and get himself together. I suspect it is some sort of oriental way of trying to pull himself out of this dire position he's got himself
into. We're going for a suplex to get him back to the ring now. Morocco gonna... Whoa!
Big, high suplex. How much more punishment can the Black Dragon take?
I don't know, but I'll tell you, Lord Alfred, I was watching carefully the face of Don Morocco, and it is a face of hate, disdain, and he has one thing in mind, and that's to destroy the Dragon. Now he's going
to
whip
him right out of wrestling. He wants to humiliate him, he wants to hurt him, and now he wants to put him out of wrestling.
Now he's going to choke him.
And there's nothing the referee can do about it because it's a no disqualification match.
Well, I'll tell you, the fans are a little bit stunned at this point in time. They are very apprehensive. Are we watching their hero? They say they're watching our hero go down.
Well, I'm becoming concerned here, Dick, because how is the Black Dragon, how is Steamers going to signal that he's had enough or finished with that thing wrapped around his neck?
Well, there's a look in shadow, the Fuge, Mr. Fuji, and he's saying, I'm enjoying every second of this, man. Look, Steamboat's starting to topple. Now the fans are starting a chant.
Well, if the fans can get him to his feet, they're going to do all they can to achieve that particular end.
But I don't know if he has any.
And indeed, Steamboat has come to his feet. And he's looking a little better than he did before, even though there's a lot of blood coming from him. He's managed to muster up enough strength to hit him one with a karate chop to the top of the head.
I don't know how he's breathing, though, Lord Albert. Look at his face. His face looks gray, as if it lost oxygen.
I can only imagine that he's using some sort of, as we said before, some sort of oriental meditation to... protect himself against this, because I don't know how any man could stand up to that.
I really don't. I've watched a lot of wrestling. I've watched it from a ringside position, and I've never seen anything like this.
And there he's showing the referee that he has control of his faculties to some degree, although that doesn't seem to be. Yes, he's showing the referee again that he still has control of some of his physical.
Look at Don Morocco. He's frustrated. What do I have to do? Literally kill this guy? Morocco suddenly jerked into a sitting position. I don't know what he has going, but he's on one knee.
Steamboat trying to get back to his feet again, and he's achieved that.
I don't know, fans.
A little bit of the way there. Let's see if he can really pull this one out of the bag.
Well, I don't know. How in the world is he standing up? Morocco is literally choking him to death.
He's digging down deep, Dick. And when you get that intensity that he had before, and it's showing now, he's going to try everything
well,
he can.
He reared back and gave Morocco a shot, gave him a double karate shot. And then Morocco took him into the turnbuckle, double chopped again.
A lot more power to Morocco's blows than those of Steamboat.
Now he's going to fight into the forehead. Oh, man, are you kidding? Oh, wow. The blood is just running in torrents down the face of Ricky Steamboat at this point in time. And now he's using the spike. He's using that thumb all wrapped in adhesive tape, I believe. Can't see it from here exactly. Taking his head to the top turnbuckle. Oh, wow.
Steamboat. Everything is going Morocco's way at the moment.
It's going right for Morocco and wrong for Steamboat. The Dragon is in really bad trouble. Now we're going back to the choking again.
Run him into that turnbuckle.
He's hanging right on the top. He's spitting blood. He looks like he's out of it. Morocco right on top of him. Oh, oh, oh. Morocco did a leaning headbutt. Whew. You're talking about literally beating a man into the ground. Morocco is just inert on top of the ring.
I'm beginning to think the referee should stop this contest right now, because something really, really bad could happen here to Steamboat if it hasn't already occurred to him. He's bleeding. He looks to be senseless.
Morocco.
He doesn't have any defense against Morocco.
Morocco literally just dug his fingers in the forehead of Ricky Steamboat. He's trying every which way to do him in. I don't know how much the man can take if he's feeling anything at all. Steamboat, I mean. Snapmare over the top rope and down again. Morocco, very workmanlike, very methodical, nothing fancy. Going back to the choke with a karate belt now, and it's the Steamboat's own belt. Oh! Steamboat stumbled. Morocco flew over him and jammed his head against the ring turnbuckle in the corner, even with the padding. That smarts.
Well, that's the first piece of luck that Steamboat has had, and let's hope that he can find some more of that luck his way, because he is in bad shape.
It may be a turning point here, Lord Alfred Hayes. Oh! Morocco was going to do a flying headbutt, but Steamboat backed off, and Morocco hit the doggone ring floor. Woo! If anything... Oh! Back body drop by the Dragon.
The power is coming back into his body. It must be that meditation, Dick. Now he's getting some sting to those chops. Morocco's still alive, though.
He really is alive. And I notice Fuji is standing riveted to the floor in front of us. Woo-ho! He hit him with everything he had. Again, he did. Still another time.
He's getting stronger and stronger as time goes by here.
Woo! Clothesline, and down he went.
It looks like Steamboat is going into that corner. He's going to make his move on him now.
He's pointing now to Morocco. Morocco is stunned, and I'm talking about... Whoa! Whoa!
Oh. Oh.
Steamboat, look at
and
that.
Back in. What a move.
You talk about an athlete, Lord Alfred. I don't believe it.
Distracted by...
Suplex.
Hey, put him back in there. Oh, his mind is functioning so clearly, and he's got him. By Fuji, that Steamboat has got himself into trouble that he couldn't extricate himself from, and yet his mind was so clear, so crystal clear, he managed to beat Morocco.
Well, Morocco's still not finished with him. He's on top of Steamboat in the other corner, and so it goes. And now he's trying to choke again, while young Barella, the referee, has been distracted temporarily by Mr. Fuji. It's all over, though, fans. The pin has been made. It's all over.
Well, not for Morocco, because he's going to keep this going.
He's taken the stick and he's plunging that stick into the forehead of Steamboat and into his stomach. And Steamboat is tied by the belt into the corner.
Well, you talk about a guy, Don Morocco, an extremely poor loser. That's evidence of it. Steamboat is just that belt was hanging over the top rope, and he was sort of suspended by it from his neck.
Steamboat used every ounce of energy he had to pull off that amazing victory. He had nothing more in him, and then Morocco attacked him very viciously behind his back.
You know, Lord Alfred, I think in the many years I've been doing professional wrestling, I think this is one of the most savage beatings I've ever seen a man take.
Here is your winner, Ricky the Dragon Steamboat.
Well, that's going to go down in the record books as a win, but as far as Morocco is concerned, I think he feels he probably got the better of that engagement.
No doubt about that. And the Steamboat, here we go, coming back. Now, here's the suplex, what we think is going to be a suplex. However, the Steamboat, look at the agility. Come up behind Morocco, takes him to the ropes to develop a little bit of leverage right on top. Boom, 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 and that's all she wrote. Woo! Well, fans, coming up next is the tag team championship as Valentine Beefcake combine to try to defend their title. Don't wander away.
Spectrum will take place on Saturday evening, February the 8th, beginning at 8 p.m. Tickets can be purchased here at the Spectrum box office and all of the usual ticket outlets in the metropolitan area. Signed to appear here at the Spectrum on Saturday, February 8th, regardless of the outcome of the next bout to enter this ring, you will see the British Bulldogs. In bouts signed, Rene Goulet will face Pedro Morales. Iron Mike Sharp will face Dan Spivey. Scott McGee will oppose Hercules Hernandez. George Wells will do battle with the adorable Adrian Adonis. The Iron Sheik will face Corporal Kirshner. And returning to this ring will be Terrible Terry Funk. His opponent, the Junkyard Dog. And ladies and gentlemen, the main event on Saturday evening, February 8th, will be a one-on-one confrontation between King Kong Bundy and his opponent, Hulk Hogan.
Supreme, Greg the Hammer Valentine, Brutus Beefcake, and that other guy. What's his name?
Johnny Valiant. Greg the Hammer, yes, and Brutus Beefcake, Johnny Valiant. What an impressive record these tag team champions have.
Well, they really have.
Yes. Since they won that championship, you've got to hand it to them. They have not turned down a challenge, I think that they have faced the toughest challenges, but here tonight is coming another tough challenge.
Well, they've had an open contract, and here they are. The British Bulldogs are going to do their thing, and they'll be back again next month, as you heard a while ago. Let's get the introduction from Mel Phillips.
This is the final bout, scheduled for one fall with a one-hour time limit, and it is for the World Tag Team Heavyweight Championship. Introducing first, the manager from New York City, Luscious Johnny Valiant. The challengers hail from England, having a total combined weight of 465 pounds, the British Bulldogs.
Well, these guys are a trip.
The opponents are the World Tag Team Champions from Seattle, Washington, weighing 249 pounds, Greg the Hammer Valentine. And his tag team partner from San Francisco, California, weighing 273 pounds, Brutus Beefcake.
I wonder who is Brutus Beefcake's couturier. he is a vision of beauty in that, what do we say, sort of a leopard skin, pseudo-leopard skin, but... Oh!
Look out!
Oh, look out, it's underway. These guys, by design, decide to kick it off their own way. Brutus Beefcake and the other champion of the tag team is Greg the Hammer Valentine. And the Bulldogs, one of them, I don't know which one, is outside the ring. Here goes the other. They're both
out. That's Dynamite Kid out outside, and that's Davey Boy Smith holding, he said, the other side. And Dynamite Kid is right in our laps here. Greg the Hammer throwing him back into the ring and chasing him back. I'm afraid they took these young British boys by surprise here.
They really did. And there's the big foot stuck out there from the corner, and he walked right into it. Oh, man. Well, the Bulldogs are getting a rude welcome here to Philadelphia in the hands of the tag team champions. And Beefcake strutting, doing his stuff.
Oh, and he's fired up as well, Beefcake. They don't take their challenges lightly, whoever they might be. And they know that the Bulldogs also have a great record, so they're going to treat them as roughly as they can and show them what they're made of.
Oh, double karate chop, and down he goes. And quickly on top of Greg Valentine, there's a kick out, so he escapes a possible pinning situation. Whoa, ducks under that hammer. Oh, close line. They both get down. You know, you talk about these wrestlers, fans, Lord Alfred. I'm just looking at the forehead of the Bulldog, and his whole forehead is just creased with scars.
Yes, he's got a lot of scar tissue on his forehead.
So
he's obviously been hurt many times there.
So all these people, these guys, they wrestle a little bit, all that. What's he trying for?
Nice hold, step over.
Yeah,
taking him in a figure four, a standing figure four. And if he holds that on, that's a very, very damaging hold. If he turns him over, it could be a submission hold.
Well, Greg the Hammer Valentine knows full well what the figure four leg lock's all about. He's applied it many times. And he knows the results, and he's on the short end of it. Oh, well, not now. Well, there's
Davey Boy Smith there, made a nice move, dropped in on that left leg of Greg the Hammer, but he did leave himself a little bit exposed, especially for that.
He had it going, and suddenly Beefcake is tagged, and he's in now. Snapmare.
Big boot from Beefcake.
Driving right into the canvas. I guess that's the idea. Two kicks out. Got to grab that one leg at least.
Yes, I don't think Brutus really knew he was going to have him beaten there. Well, I think Brutus is just showing them that he can pin him.
Well, Beefcake just dropped him off the top rope with all that weight. Got caught right across the neck. He's in the bad part of town, too. He's not even near his partner for tagging purposes. However, tag made now by Bruce Beefcake with Greg the Hammer Valentine. Now they're both giving it to him. The parting shot by Beefcake as Valentine takes over now. Swings his man into the middle of the ring. Now he goes for the figure four, huh?
The champions are certainly showing the English boys some good teamwork here.
He's grabbing for the tights. We may see an X-rated wrestling match here. Well, he broke the hold, and I got news for you. Knowing what the figure four leg lock can do, I'm on his side for grabbing the tights the way he did. Valentine grabbed the wrong guy, and now Beefcake, without any tag, is in the ring.
And that is a blatant choke hold right in front of the referee, and he calls it straight away.
Plus the fact that he didn't even make a tag.
Going for a spinning leg lock here on Davey Boy Smith, and that is another punishing hold. And Davey Boy Smith has taken a lot of punishment to his legs there. Now he's going for that figure four. He just cannot seem to get it. He's almost there. And he's put the lock on. Can he put as much power into that as Greg the Hammer can?
I don't think that Beefcake really has it going as much as he thinks he does. I think he's on the short end. There's nobody there to tag. He's got the rope. Now they've got to break it.
Their plan obviously here is to work on the legs of Davey Boy Smith. I don't know why, because he certainly hasn't got weak legs by any means. In fact, there's not a weakness in either of these men.
Well, the Dynamite Kid's waiting outside, as is his partner, Davey Boy Smith, getting the short end there, and now the tag made. Here's Valentine inside. Pulls him by the hair, smacks him across the face. Again, you talk about arrogance and a disdain for... Oh, brought that head right down to the midsection.
The champions' teamwork is really... showing them up to be a good team here, showing them well, and I'm afraid the English boys at this moment are not doing terribly well.
He's got to stretch the hamstring, maybe. No, step over to him.
Uh-oh, this is dangerous.
Whoa! One, two, close. Close.
Valentine had to let that go, otherwise he would have been counted out.
That's right. He had himself, so to speak.
And we'd have had new champions then.
Whoa!
Something Davey Boy Smith is showing us something.
Valentine's holding on now. The Davey Boy. Until Bruce Beefcake can get in. The referee's got to do something about that. It's the tag's made, then it's made. The other guy out of... Are we out of time?
What is that? What is that bell there?
I don't know.
Well, Bruce Beefcake is taking no notice of it anyway. Well, he's still going for that spinning leg lock. And Davey Boy's going to make a tag here.
Maybe not.
No, he didn't quite have enough there to make that tag.
Going for a suplex. Whoa!
Valentine's trying to... A reverse suplex by
Davey Boy Smith. And
the Dynamite Kid is in.
Headbutt. Spinning the Beefcake upside down.
And he's got him down there.
One, two, kicks away.
We were very close to having new champions then. And now Brutus Beefcake is looking really worried. Oh, nice, very, very
one,
quick move
two,
by the Dynamite Kid. So close again.
He's going to...
A snap there. Watch the speed of this. Look at that.
He is fast.
And a save by Valentine.
Gets to the end.
And he tags in Davey Boy Smith. And Davey Boy comes in. He's going for a power slam. He takes him up so easy. This man has just tremendous power. Beautiful power slam.
One, two.
And once again, teamwork saves the champions. And now they look as if they're in big trouble, because he's put his hands on the referee, something he shouldn't have.
The referee's
trying. And the referee cannot see that Davey Boy Smith is actually pinned. And Valentine
Valentine's coming into the ring now. Valiant.
This is mayhem.
Valiant, what is Valiant doing in there? Come on, referee. This is interference. Stop it.
Well, that's all over now. All over now, fans. Looks like a disqualification. Headbutt on Valentine. And he rolls out.
Well, I tell you, Valiant saved his team there because they certainly looked as if they were going to lose that coveted world championship to the English Bulldogs.
I'll tell you, Lord Alfred, we almost had the British Bulldogs as the new tag team champions right here in Philadelphia.
That was the closest the champions have come to losing a decision.
Very, very close. Let's get the announcement.
The winners of this bout by disqualification, the British Bulldogs.
Well, that's the story. And the champions are a little upset. They lost the match, but retained their belts, and that's the way it is.
And certainly the Bulldogs didn't want it to finish in such a method.
No. Well, I don't know much more we can say. Looks to be about all we can say right now.
What a fantastic night we had here, Dick. I cannot believe some of the upsets that took place here tonight. Without a doubt, the British Bulldogs winning was an upset, even though they haven't got those belts.
Well, that's about all she wrote. We'll be back here again on February the 8th. For Lord Alfred Hayes, this is Dick Graham. Hope you have a great new year. Have a great month. We'll see you on February 8th. Good night, all.
Prism's got.
But you didn't even graduate!
A farewell fandango for the groomer! Innocent critters crossed on the highway of life!
Join five best friends on the road.
Are you crazy? Are you out of your mind?
Fandango.
It's the stuff pleasant to made of, son.